coast and around the world. It's time to praise the Lord. Praise the Lord covers the major Christian events in America and across the world, from the heart of Europe. The tip of Africa. From the centers of Asia. To Central and South America. You're a part of the world's largest prayer and praise gathering. Joining us from Southern California are author, evangelist, and founder of Oral Roberts University, Dr. Oral Roberts. Ministering music, country western gospel singer and recording artist, Vern Jackson. Ready to take your calls, prayer partners around America.
To shore, border to border, it's time to praise the Lord. Do you know why? I hold in my hand, dear friends, an historic document. And I have purposely waited till tonight to sign it so that our friend and brother Oral Roberts can say a word of blessing and faith and just touch it with me and believe God for a speedy completion to it. This is the first agreement that has already been faxed to Mr. Robert Choi of the New Hong Kong Development Authority in the People's Republic of China. The first Christian television station on the People's Republic of China is on the way in Jesus' name. And I think we ought to rejoice. Rejoice, rejoice. Is that historic? Mao Zedong will turn over in his grave tonight as we literally put the ink to the contract and get this project underway. So I know you'll join me as we sign that on your behalf, because it will be your station. And I may just take you to the end of the world one more time. Brother Oral didn't get to see that. And there is, dear friends, literally a place on this earth known as, at least by the Chinese, a place known as the literal ends of the earth. And I stood there a few days ago, and I think my liver is now back in its normal place after bouncing for 6 hours over the awfulest road I've ever bumped on and nearly getting killed by running over 100,000 rickshaws and about 5,000 hogs, and I forget what all we nearly hit on the way down there. But I made it, by the grace of God, to the end of the world. Now, yes, thank you. I will take that applause. I feel I earned that. My poor old carcass is just now getting back into shape. But I think we should just have a word of prayer, and I've got some other exciting news to share with you. Get your Bibles out. Brother Oral Roberts, one of God's seven-star generals, is here tonight, and he's going to take us on a little adventure through the Word of God. And I think I about half got him talked into doing a little weekly Bible study right here on the... Can you've got more influence over him than I do, do you think?
Yes, I think we're going to have a little Bible story by Dr. Roberts. Wouldn't that be incredible? You know, we were talking about that today, knowing that he is just has a wealth of knowledge that we'll never know unless he gets it on tape. And then lets our generation learn it, and our children, and our children's children. And once we get it on tape, then we've got it forever. Yes. And I just want him to do... I asked him tonight something very wonderful. I said, Dr. Roberts, what is the greatest thing greatest revelation that the Lord has ever given you that changed your life the most. And he's going to let us know that tonight.
Did he tell you?
No, but he's going to tell us all.
Together
and
tonight.
You know what I told him it was for me? Do you know what it honestly is for me? I believe what changed my life more than anything was his teaching on seed faith giving. I believe it has done more for me personally, just to see the Lord act every time I give. And it works. And he taught us that. And I love that. And it could change every single person's life if they would just get that truth. And he has so many more, and he's going to be teaching us. Isn't that beautiful?
I can't wait to hear the greatest revelation that Brother Oral Roberts believes the Lord ever gave to him. All right. And then Tim Penland is here, and he has a new guest that he's going to introduce to us, another Tim, and an update on China Cry. Did you know China Cry is still... I'm not going to tell you. Tim will tell you in just a little bit. Is that hooking him? Yeah, okay.
You may read a cute little scripture about the ends of the world?
Please.
That was just so cute to hear that there was literally a sign that said, this is the end of the world, and it's carved into a rock. And this is what the Word says about that in Acts 1:8. It says, but when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, you will receive power to testify about me with great effect to the people in Jerusalem, throughout Judea, in Samaria, and to the ends of the earth. Isn't that incredible?
Yes.
About my death and resurrection. So that's what we're to be telling. That's beautiful. Tonight, just as I was driving over and knowing that Dr. Roberts was going to be on, I was driving my own car, and at the red lights is when I always just, you know, have my Bible right there, and I open it. And I said, Lord, what would you have me read tonight? And it opened to Mark 6. And this is so beautiful. Mark 5, actually, about healings. And let's just read some wonderful things. When Jesus had gone across by boat to the other side of the lake, a vast crowd gathered around him on the shore. The leader of the local synagogue, whose name was Jairus, came and fell down before him, pleading with him to heal his little daughter. She's at the point of death, he said in desperation. Please come and place your hands on her and make her live. And Jesus went with him, and the crowd thronged behind. In the crowd was a woman who had been sick for 12 years with a hemorrhage. She had suffered much from many doctors through the years and had become poor from paying them and was no better off, but in fact worse. Sorry, Dr. Whitaker. I didn't write it. She had heard all about the wonderful miracles that Jesus did, and that is why she came up behind him through the crowd and touched his clothes. For she thought to herself, if I can just touch his clothing, I will be healed. And sure enough, as soon as she touched him, the bleeding stopped, and she knew she was well. Jesus realized at once that healing power had gone out from him. So he turned around to the crowd and asked, who touched my clothes? His disciples said to him, oh, all this crowd pressing around you, and you ask who touched you? But he kept on looking around to see who it had done it. Then the frightened woman, trembling at the realization of what had happened to her, came and fell at his feet and told him what she had done. And he said to her, daughter, your faith has made you well. So go in peace, healed of your disease. And while he was still talking to her, messengers arrived from Jairus' home with the news that it was too late, that his daughter was dead, and there was no point in coming. But Jesus ignored their comments and said to Jairus, don't be afraid. Just trust me. Then Jesus halted the crowd and wouldn't let anyone go on with him to Jairus' home except Peter and James and John. And when they arrived, Jesus saw that all was in great confusion with unrestrained weeping and wailing. He went inside and spoke to the people. "Why all this weeping and commotion?" he asked. "The child isn't dead. She's only asleep." And they laughed at him in bitter derision. But he told them all to leave. And taking the little girl's father and mother and his three disciples, he went into the room where she was lying. Taking her up by the hand, he said to her, "Get up, little girl." And she jumped up and walked around, and her parents just couldn't get over it. And Jesus instructed them very earnestly not to tell what had happened, and told them, "Give her something to eat." That's Mark. Mark 5, and the end of the chapter. Isn't that beautiful?
Well, I'm sure before this evening is over, Brother Roberts will lead us in a great prayer for divine healing. So if you're hurting tonight, if you're suffering, if you have reached a point where medical science says there's no hope, why not get a second opinion from the great physician tonight? And let us be your prayer partner and agree with you. And what a joy to have one of God's great champions of the faith here tonight to bless us and lead us. In fact, why don't we just go down and have Brother Roberts lead us in our prayer time. Why don't you all say hello to and welcome to Praise the Lord, Dr. Oral Roberts. How's my buddy? God bless you. Good to see you tonight. Okay, I'll pin you. That's good enough right there. Yes, we're ready. I know a lot of folks are anxious to hear kind of a new phase of ministry that you're moving into these days, and we'll do that a little bit later. But right now, I wish you just open this great Praise the Lord service in prayer tonight. Let's just invite the precious Holy Spirit to come.
Blessed Holy Spirit, we know the power is in you. Amen. And when the Father sent the Son to go to the cross for us, he was only willing to come because you went with him and you came by him. And you gave the power to his disciples once he went away. And blessed Holy Spirit, we call you now in your great delivering and healing power. We feel you.
Amen.
We feel you going through us. Ola kama mashila bakula bana. From the very crown of our head to the soles of our feet, we feel the warmth and the healing flow of Jesus. And dear friend, we're here. We're so glad you're here. We wanted you to be here. We wanted you to be part of this service. And when Paul and Jen asked me to come, I wanted you to be here, and they wanted you to be here. And I pray for you now that beginning now your healing starts, and your deliverance starts, and your supply starts, and your life change starts.
Amen.
And your new hope starts, and the joy drives the gloom away. And before we ever get into the deeper part, start taking it now.
Amen.
Because Jesus is here. Amen. And amen.
Amen and amen. Praise the Lord. Well, I didn't even give him a proper introduction, but this is one brother that really doesn't need an introduction on Trinity Broadcasting. Let me just make sure my figures are right, though. We know that you're the founder of Oral Roberts University. Is this its 28th year?
It is the 29th. The next
29th.
Year, it'll be the 30th year.
29th year with, this says, 4,324 students, but I bet it's more than that now.
That's a 6% increase from last year. Thank God we had an increase.
Moving up. One of these days, it'll hit that 5,000 mark. You can
yes,
be sure of
we
that.
Think we'll be there in 3 years, 5,000.
Oral Roberts University is a world-class university with undergraduate, graduate programs, and I'm sure Brother Oral will tell us more about that, but I'm anxious to hear in just a minute more about maybe a new little phase that the Lord is moving our dear brother into.
Are you ready now?
I'll
if
tell you
not,
what.
Why we'll wait.
Let me tell you what
we
need.
Because, you know, I'm raring to go.
Oh, I know it. I mean,
the healing presence has come back on me.
I'm ready to go with you.
I've already had four healing services in the last 5 weeks.
I know.
I'll soon be having another one, so you better hold me down.
All I want to know is the old tent coming back out again?
I don't need the tent. I need the guy in the tent.
Okay. All right. I want to know all about it, but I want you to go with me to the end of the world in just a minute. And then I want you to bless this agreement as we sign it tonight for the First Christian Station in the People's Republic of China. But Vern Jackson is here. You know what we need is a little time, because Brother Roberts, I see the lines are jammed, and I know people are wanting to get their prayer requests and their comments in tonight. And if you've got a little message to Brother Oral, send it in. If you have a prayer request, send it in. We'll collect them all. See, Trinity and the Praise the Lord program, it's kind of like they're all coming in the doors right now, and we just need a little time to get them in, get them seated, and get on the phone and get checked in with us. And we're going to have a healing service tonight. We're going to have a prayer and praise service. We're going to go to the end of the world. We're going to take the People's Republic of China. I mean, the devil is in big trouble tonight. He really is. And besides all that, we got our must-carry law passed by the Congress.
Glory to God.
We ought to
give praise
States
for that.
Of America.
Praise for that.
Glory. And I've got a little message. I promised the cable industry I'd talk to you a little bit tonight. I'm not mad at you. We're with you. We spend over $2.5 million a year into the cable industry. We are a cable programmer. And this must-carry law and some of the other things, hey, I know that any law that Congress passes has certain flaws in it, certain things that aren't fair to all parties. I understand that. But I've got some good news for the cable industry tonight. We're going to work with you.
Yes.
We're going to agree with you. We're going to bless you if you'll work with us. And I'm going to tell you how in a little bit that's going to be accomplished. Okay? So I will say thank you basically to the... Didn't know if I'd ever say this, but I'm saying thanks to the Democrats tonight, because they are the ones who pushed this through.
Well, some of us Democrats are saved.
That's right.
Are you a Democrat, Brother Orr?
Brother, when I grew up in Oklahoma, if you weren't a Democrat, you didn't spend the night.
I know. You had to get out of town before sundown.
Well, where did you go?
Well, I wrote President Bush a letter, and I asked him please not to veto it. And I know many of you called the White House, wrote to the White House. For whatever reasons, our good president decided he had to veto it. I told him if he did, and he wrote me back a very personal letter telling me all the reasons why he had to veto this, which I don't agree with, I'm sorry. And I told him if he vetoed this, I would have to express my profoundest disappointment. And take that any way you want to, but I am very, very disappointed in that action. That's the bad news. The good news is the Congress, our Senate, and our House of Representatives, in an overwhelming majority, overrode that presidential veto, and the new cable law is law now. And that should mean, now we don't yet know quite how the dust is all going to settle here, but when it all settles, we believe that it will mean literally millions of new homes that will be accessed by cable.
That.
For Trinity Broadcasting Network and Christian television.
Yes.
For God be the glory, great things he has done. Who's directing this? Get a picture of my little family up there. I heard you clapping, but now I want the media to see that this is not hand applause tonight. This is live bodies saying thank the Lord for this great victory that the Lord has given to us. Vern Jackson is going to bless us as many of you call in now, your prayer requests and other messages to us tonight. And higher is now number?
Well, we just don't know yet. We may know a little later.
Latest report was 20, I understand. But has it moved up further?
No, not yet,
know?
No.
Okay.
We hadn't announced that. We were going to in a minute and make a big surprise out of it and a wonderful little thing, but now that you phoned it,
you said
okay.
That the other night on
no,
the air.
No, we haven't yet.
Oh, I see. Well, I blew your thunder, didn't I?
I said it to you on the phone.
Oh, sorry.
No, Vern
didn't hear a thing.
No,
okay.
He didn't hear a thing.
Vern will tell you the exciting
heard
news
a thing.
About Higher Than I've Ever Been. He's going to start with Amazing Grace, one of our grand old men. Sorry about that. And then number whatever, higher than I've ever been before. Let's welcome Vern Jackson.
Honestly, the Tebian family just can't believe what's happening to this album. The very first album that we ever produced, and it has gone on Billboard magazine from 28. Did it come in 28?
28.
And this week it has come out at number 20. And I told Paul on the phone the other day, he's so cute, I love it.
Well, what a joy it is to be here. Again, I thank the partners for helping this to happen, and of course the Lord, because the Lord gave me this instrument that I have that I call my voice and has allowed me to use it here at TBN. And I also want to thank this lady, Jan, and Paul. Thank you so much for bringing me in here, into the family here, and allowing me to do this and having the faith in me that we could do this. And you know, China Cry has gone number one. We have gone number one in some of the charts. We haven't gone to Billboard number one yet, but I just have to believe that because both of these projects were not done to glorify any of us, not to glorify TBN, but to glorify the Lord Jesus Christ. And He has allowed this both of these projects to go number one. Thank you so much.
I love it. We know that you were just back in Nashville for a whole week, and you just heard from everybody, all the DJs, that they're playing it and it's being requested. And then you got some news from Phoenix that it's the number one bestseller there in all the bookstores.
It's the number one bestseller in all the bookstores in Phoenix, and it's just going crazy. This lady called in from one of the bookstores yesterday and just said they're just selling just tremendous amounts in just a matter of days, and it's just blowing me away.
I love it. It's all the little old ladies over there that just love you.
I love you too, ladies. Thank you so much, partners.
If you were 18, this wouldn't be happening, but it's because you're almost 60 that it's happening.
That's not that funny.
Isn't this incredible? You know, it did go in the Christian Voice magazine from Nashville. It went to number one in what?
In both the retail sales and distributor sales. And also it was a pick hit in Singing News magazine. We came in there on the top 10 pick hits, number six, and it was a pick hit, gold, whatever that means. And it's not quite as good as platinum, but it's better than silver and bronze. So this whole thing, this whole experience is just every week. It's something else, and it just seems like it's gaining momentum, and it just goes faster and faster. I love it too.
And we just have to thank Judy Peavyhouse and Ronnie Henson for writing the song, and your wife Sonny for finding it.
Yeah.
And then the Lord just putting it all together. And partners, it is just up to you. You know, it's so incredible, our TBN partners. You tell them to do something, and they're going to do it. You know, they just do it. And you're calling your radio stations, and you're going out and buying this album. And we just believe that in Billboard, it's going to be number one. This is incredible. You don't realize who he's in among here. I mean, like Carmen and Amy Grant and I mean, they're below him, you know. And we love it. We just what do you predict?
Up there.
Do you believe it's going to be number one?
By faith. By faith.
I do too.
Yeah.
Do you believe it?
Hey.
Why not?
With me, it
why
already
not?
Is.
I was. I talked to Ronnie Henson when I was in Nashville, and Ronnie's just thrilled. And then Judy called me yesterday. Judy Peavyhouse from Oklahoma. And she was on the road with a group for 15 years, and she says that she gets more enjoyment in just 5 minutes while I'm singing this song than she did the whole 15 years being on the road. So, again, thank you, Judy and Ronnie, for writing this wonderful song, and we need another one. One more time, higher than I've ever been.
I've heard once a bird has a broken wing, he can never fly high anymore. Let me tell you what I know, it's not always so, 'cause once I lay broken and so I fell from above like a wounded dove, with no hope of ever flying again. But with grace from above and God's marvelous love, I'm flying higher than I've ever been. Higher than I've ever been. Higher than yesterday's sin. Where eagles
Then old Satan, like a vulture, he swept low in my darkest hour. That's when he came to devour what's left of my wretched, my dying soul. God was not finished yet. He saw more good than I ever saw in me. Now I live above the doubt, so high in the clouds that I can't see the tops of the trees.
That song more every time I hear it.
Amen.
I think it's because who of us has not had a broken wing at one time or another, and Satan has lied that same lie to all of us. But God has picked us up, and we're all flying higher than we've ever flown before. And if you have that broken wing and Satan's on you tonight and telling you that lie, tell him to get the blazes out of there. And almost said a bad word there. But we're going to pray with you and agree with you and believe God with you tonight for a miracle. Brother Roberts, I want you just to touch this agreement with me tonight. And partners, would you all just reach your hands out? This is history in the making. I just got back from the end of the world, the southernmost tip of the People's Republic of China. And I'll take you there in a minute or two. And a fine Chinese-American gentleman, Christian gentleman, is building a new city. He has purchased 25,000 acres of property in the island of Hainan. Hainan Island. I keep trying to learn how to properly say that, but it is the southernmost point, as I said, in the People's Republic of China. And this is a memorandum of intent. It's the first agreement that we will sign. We are exchanging these letters. Mr. Choi and I shook hands on this deal in Haikou City just a few days ago. And this is, our attorneys have now authored the first memorandum of intent that I sign now in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. And I want all of you in a moment to reach your hands out and together, as Brother Oral Roberts leads us, I want us to believe God for this great breakthrough.
So, Spirit of God, that breathes over your earth and upon all human flesh, who is determined that the gospel of Jesus shall go to every man, woman, and child,
Lord, we
I bless this.
Amen.
Along with thousands upon thousands of the partners,
Jesus,
this great
Jesus,
Trinity
Jesus.
Broadcasting Network.
Glory.
And as partners together with Paul and Jan, and as we lift our voices for that brother who is part of this in China.
Yes, Lord.
We so
Robert
agree
tonight in Jesus' Jesus.
In Christ's name, that it shall be so.
Amen.
And we shall not come out of the agreement.
Yes, amen.
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 And amen. Amen.
And amen. And everybody said,
amen.
Amen. Amen. Will you go with me for 5 more minutes, and then we're going to get into some good preaching, teaching, whatever the Lord wants with Brother Oral Roberts. And I've got to find out what this greatest revelation that the Lord
after he teaches
has revealed to Brother Oral Roberts. Well, watch your screens. It'll take us just about... It took me, dear friends, several days and a jarring 6-hour trip there and 6 hours back, 12 hours on the road. We should have taken some of those pictures, Danny, is what we should have done. But anyway, go with me for 5 minutes to the end of the world. There really is such a place, you know. Welcome to the end of the world. I suppose this would be the very last place in all the world I would ever expect to be here in the People's Republic of China. But dear friends, believe it or not, there is a spot on earth, according to Chinese tradition, that is literally the end of the world, attested to by the sign carved in the huge granite boulder behind me. Little history quickly. According to Chinese culture and tradition, China for centuries has been the center of the earth. In fact, one of the symbols, one of the first symbols of the word for China is a little rectangle with a line right down through the middle of it, meaning symbolically this is the center of the earth. Well, here on Hunan Island, which is the southernmost point in all of the People's Republic of China, it was simply considered, believe it or not, your choice, the end of the world. Well, that brings up many, many thoughts and many, many ideas. First of all, there's some scripture that talks about that, which I want to speak to you about in a moment. But the good news I want to share with you before we go any further is simply this. Just yesterday, with Mr. Choi, we shook hands on an agreement in principle. Are you ready for this? To literally build the first Christian television station on the People's Republic of China here on Hunan Island, the southernmost point. It is known as, actually, the door to China. A great development is being planned, and a huge city is under construction. And Mr. Choi, the chairman of this great project, a wonderful Christian Chinese-American gentleman, has given us the privilege and the opportunity to literally construct and build China. Are you ready for this, dear partner? Mainland China's first Christian television station. Actually, I think it will probably be the very first Christian station in all of Asia. Of course, Nora Lam has had Christian programming in Taiwan for many years. But now, dear friends, a full Christian station on the soil of the People's Republic of China. I can't hardly stand it. I'm so excited as I stand here literally at what the Chinese have taught and believe for centuries to be literally the end of the world. Listen to what Jesus says in Matthew chapter 28 after that glorious story of his resurrection, and he told the women who met him at the tomb that morning, "Go quickly and tell my disciples that I am risen from the dead, and behold, I go to Galilee. There I shall see you. Lo, I have told you." And they departed quickly and with great joy, and did run to tell. And as they went to tell his disciples, behold, Jesus met them, saying, "All hail," and they came and held him by the feet and worshipped him. Then Jesus said unto them, "Be not afraid, go tell my brethren." Again and again in this passage, Jesus repeats it and the angel repeats it. We are to go quickly and tell. And then finally, his last word before he goes back to his heavenly Father, he says, "Go ye therefore and teach or tell all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost, teaching them to observe all things whatsoever I have commanded you." Here it is. "And lo, I am with you always, even unto the end of the world." Here we are. I'll tell you,
Somebody, you've heard the old story, or you've heard the little cliche. This ain't the jumping off place, but you can see it from here. Friends, we are at the jumping off place, for sure. Beyond us is simply the Southern Pacific Ocean, I guess. This is literally, according to Chinese tradition and to those who are around us here, the literal end of the world. And then one final scripture over in Acts chapter 2. When the great power of the Holy Spirit had come upon his disciples, he said, "But ye shall receive power. After that the Holy Ghost is come upon you, ye shall be my witnesses unto Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, and unto the uttermost part of the earth." Dear partners, we have built stations literally around the world. We have gone to Africa. We have gone to Europe. We have gone to South America. We've gone to Central America. We've gone to the islands of the sea. Now, perhaps this is God's plan. Before he returns in power and glory, he has sent you and me literally to the end of the world. Oh, join with me in praise to our wonderful Heavenly Father that he has opened the door to mainland China. For this is only the beginning. Just as we built the first station on the soil of Africa at the southernmost tip, and now it is flaming northward, so I believe God has opened the door to mainland China. And in the southernmost tip, at the end of the world, we will literally send this gospel all the way up through mainland China and tell a quarter of the world's population the old, old story of Jesus and his love. Partners, rejoice. You have come with me today, of all places, to the very ends of the earth, here at the southernmost tip of mainland China. So we rejoice that now the gospel has come to this part of the world, and now join with me and agree with me and pray with me that it will spring northward until all of the 1,300,000,000 precious Chinese souls that have been deprived so many years of the preaching of the gospel of Jesus Christ will also hear the good news and be saved. Rejoice, rejoice, rejoice that the gospel has now come by Christian television literally to the end of the world. So, for now, goodbye. God love you, we love you, and remember, let everything that hath breath keep on praising the Lord. You went with me to the end of the world tonight. In fact, I brought a piece of their money back, and literally on the back of their currency is the picture of the great rock that you just saw there with the literal message carved in the rock. This is the end of the world. So, believe it or not, anyway, we were there, whatever you want to call it.
I give you a personal guarantee that Oral Roberts University graduates will be at the end of the world with you in that station.
Amen.
Helping to operate it. And I looked in my wallet. I wanted to give you my wallet. I only had $50 in it, but I give this as a symbol of 50 stations in mainland China.
Oh, Brother Robert.
As a seed of
bless
faith.
You, sweetheart.
As a seed that God will multiply it. Multiply it.
Lord, Lord, Lord. Precious
Shibakash.
Seed. Lord, let's bless it right
oh,
now.
Oh, yes, Lord.
Father, we thank you. This is literally the first seed that has been planted in this great new open door that you, by your Spirit, have opened. Bless Brother and Sister Roberts. Bless Oral Roberts University. Bless them abundantly. You have, but Lord, bless them even more as they plant literally the very first seed in this mighty, mighty door
thank
that
you,
has
God.
Opened to you and to your kingdom. Thank you for it. Multiply it 1,000,000,000. Fold, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Well, there's 1,300,000,000 in China, so that's only $1 a piece. Well, hey, it's great to have Brother Roberts with us tonight. Please give us a little update and tell us you are hitting the evangelistic trail again, I hear.
Well, I am. I wondered when God would let me do it. He interrupted me at the peak of my healing ministry in the 60s and told me to build him a university.
Yes, sir.
To build it on his authority and on the Holy Spirit, and to raise up my students to hear his voice and to go where his light is dim. His voice is heard small, his power is not known, even to the uttermost parts of the earth, the end of the world. And in that the work would exceed mine, in that he's well pleased. And now, with Richard growing so much and getting his graduate degrees and becoming the executive vice president now for several years, he's running 67% of it, and God is releasing me to go back on the field of healing.
I love it.
I tell you,
I love it.
There's a roll in. I think you have someone I just prayed for.
All right.
Is that here?
Could we see it right now?
I think it's here.
In fact, just before you roll it in, let me just say, you're going to be where? Up at Melody Land in just
Richard
a few days?
Richard and I are going to be at Melody Land, across from Disneyland.
Disneyland here
at Ralph Wilkerson's great building. And yes, there it is on the last 2 days this month, mm-hmm. October 30th, 39, November 1, Friday, Saturday, and Sunday. We're going to be praying for the sick, and we welcome you. Oh, hallelujah. I just wish it was now. I wish it was now.
Well, it is.
Power running down my arm, the healing power down through my right hand.
We'll pray tonight.
Brother, God has done me a favor. ORU is moving on. Praise God.
Glory.
And now I get to go.
Oh, and what God will do tonight, only He knows right now. But
yes,
if you are suffering, hurry. Get to your phone and send your prayer requests in. We're up and ready, and I think this, takes us down to Florida somewhere, where you were just in a healing meeting?
Yes, it was in Orlando Christian Center with Benny Hinn.
Oh, Lord.
My dear friend and yours. And that was about 3 or 4 Sundays ago that this happened.
So let's go right now,
okay,
and we'll take a peek at what the Lord did.
Dr. Roberts, this man has had a stroke. He's had a pain in his shoulder, and it won't go away. It's just constant pain.
You're the man with the shoulder. When did the stroke come, brother?
I am Sylvester Edwards,
yes.
your partner.
Yes. Don't touch me right now. When did this happen?
About 16 years ago.
And it's also grabbed
the
side of your mouth.
Yes.
Is it the left side?
The left side. Dead.
The Lord's been talking to you about healing you.
Yes.
What's he been saying?
To come to you.
That I would come.
Yes.
Therefore, God has somebody to pray for somebody. Whoever is sick, God has somebody he's going to touch who's able to pray for you. Don't ever give up if I fail or if you're in a bitter hand crusade and it doesn't come, or wherever you are. If it doesn't come, don't give up. We're not the healers. We're servants. We're instruments. God is the healer. Don't give up. Loose him and let him go. Let him handle himself. Let him handle himself. Brother, it's coming out your feet. That thing is leaving out your feet. That's it. Lie down. Now then, by the power of God, get up. Get up. Get up. Get up. That's it. Move it out. Glory to God. Yes. Hallelujah. Love you too. Turn around here. Say, my speech
is clear. My speech is clear.
I can talk again. I can move my arms again.
Own
up. Move them. I can move them.
Oh,
yes.
Praise God.
Yes, praise God.
Jesus is alive and well. And I am well too.
Oh, Brother Robert. The thrill never leaves, although you've seen this many, many times.
It's come back, brother. It's running down that arm and that hand.
Glory,
you.
Glory, glory.
Oh, glory to God. I don't know if I sit here or not.
Well, I want us to just do whatever the Holy Spirit wants tonight. I know you've got a little word from the Word, but...
Dear Jan was up there reading, and I was so glad that she read a portion of this. And Jan, I want to read it again, if you don't mind, because I want to read it in your place. I want you to know one thing. When I read from Mark chapter 5, beginning at verse 25, that everything Jesus did had a purpose for you and for me.
Yeah.
There'll be some strange things in this, and when we get to a certain point, I believe I'm going to show you the most profound thing God ever showed me. I believe that seed faith is the greatest discovery God ever had me make, the power of seed faith. But in the healing ministry, I want to show it to you, because God just revealed to me recently what the whole thing is about in my life. But now listen. And a certain woman, which had an issue of blood 12 years. Let's think about a certain person. Let's think about you. I think about Oral Roberts. I think about me 57 years ago when I was bleeding to death in my lungs, born a stutterer. I was that certain boy.
Yeah.
And... We're told here that she suffered many things from many physicians, and had spent all that she had with nothing bettered, but rather grew worse. And that is nothing against doctors. It simply means that medical science moves forward a little at a time, and sometimes you, that certain person, may be in between those certain times, and medicine can't do anything at that point. I was there. Because of my mother's family, the Indian side, where the TB was, it had settled on me, but there were no antibiotic drugs. See, I was in between that advance of medicine. Today, there are antibiotic drugs that we didn't have, so I was going to die. Mm-hmm. So think of yourself. Something's happened to you, and you're worse. And no matter what you spent, you're not better, but you are worse. And you're wondering if you're going to get well. And what are we told next? When she had heard of Jesus. This always happens. You may have thought you never heard of him. And maybe you think that you've heard of him all your life. I'd like to remind you of an incident when I was called with my wife to pray for a family. And when we got there, the wife told me about her husband, who was really desperate. I mean desperate, in need of deliverance from God. When I started to pray for him, he knew me. And he said, Oral, and pardon this language, but this is what he said. What in the hell does Jesus have to do with this? Mm. And I called him by his first name. I said, well, you have asked the right question, but you've asked it with the wrong words. Well, he said, how should I ask the question? You said, what in the hell did Jesus have to do with this? You should have said, what in the heaven does Jesus have to do with us, with this? Because Jesus isn't in the hell business. Mm-hmm. He's in the heaven business.
Yeah, amen.
He's not in the sickness business. He's in the health business. He's not in the sin business. He's in the salvation business.
Amen.
And I just saw that man and his wife a few days ago. I was coming out of a building, and they were driving a brand new red car. And I heard this car stopped, and the doors opened, and they jumped out, and both of them ran and threw their arms around me. God had finally healed that man when he got out of hell and got into heaven.
You know, glory. Yes.
For the glory,
amen,
of God. And she heard of Jesus. Now, what did she hear? What have you heard? The Bible says that faith comes by hearing. Hearing by the Word of God. And yet, I grew up 17 years and heard that name all my life and had never heard it. Hmm. You understand what I'm saying?
Yes.
And when she had heard of Jesus, she came in the crowd behind him. and touched his garment, for she said. Now she said. When she heard, first she heard. You're not going to get to the second point till you hear. Have you really heard of the real Jesus? Mm. Of the man with a healing hand on his wrist?
Yes.
Have you heard of the Jesus who, when he speaks, his word gives life. Amen. And lifts you out of nothing into something. Jesus. From the lowest pit to the highest heaven. Jesus. From the most dreaded disease to the most radiant health. Mm-hmm. Have you heard of that Jesus? Mm-hmm. When she heard, then it says she said. She said, mm-hmm. If I can come in that crowd and get up this close and touch the hem of his garment, just touch his clothes. You see, she never even thought that she had any opportunity to touch him or to be near him face to face. If she could come behind. And do you feel that way about this man Jesus? Even though I didn't serve him, I had a reverence about him while I had tuberculosis so badly. I had a deep reverence. And she said, if I can just come behind and touch his clothes, I shall be whole. And she did, and straightway the fountain of her blood was dried up. Mm-hmm. Now, I want you to know there's a power of God that's flowing in this universe. Amen. It's flowing right through you right now. And it rearranges the biological, physiological things that have gotten wrong.
Yes.
In yourself. Paul said when he got to the end of the world over in China, later, after having 12 hours of bumpy roads, and I know what that means, he really had to believe for the rearrangement of his liver, for the parts of his body, And that's what disease does. It rearranges the way your body's supposed to operate.
Yeah.
And when she touched him, she felt.
Yeah.
First she heard. Have you really heard of Jesus? Is this the first time in all your life that you've really heard that Jesus is real? He's not just a name.
Oh,
Jesus. He's real.
Oh.
And secondly, are you ready to say, if I can just reach out and touch those clothes, I shall be made whole.
Jeez.
And she felt in her body. She felt it in her body. What did she feel? The flow of the blood that was flowing out of her, evidently it was some menstrual disease that the medicine at that time had no control over, and it was flooding all the time. You can see her skin and bones now. She's at the end of her world. Mm. And when she touches this man, she found the equal power of health to more than equal the power of death.
Yes.
That was taking place.
Oh,
in her body.
Lord.
And she felt. Yes. In her body. I remember when the man, Brother George Muncy, touched me when I had the tuberculosis and the power went in my lungs, and I'd had to breathe off the top of them because if I breathed deep, I hemorrhaged. I took that deep breath all the way down. I hollered, glory to God, I can breathe. If you've never had it, you don't know what I'm talking about. If you've never been that certain person with that disease that medicine tried but could not cure, and she felt. In her body, I believe in the feeling of healing.
Amen.
Amen. Yes, I do. I do too.
Yes.
I believe in the feeling.
Yes.
Of healing.
Yes. Thank you.
Kolaba shaba kolaba.
Hallelujah.
I believe in the feeling.
Praise you.
Of healing.
Praise.
They say you can't feel God. How could you feel? How could you not feel the God who scooped out the bed for the ocean, who flung the stars from his fingertips, who hung the earth on nothing, who's here right now to set you free? How could you not feel God in your being, in your body?
Glory.
And she felt in her body that she was healed of that plague, and that's what sickness is. It's a plague.
That's right.
Yes. Amen.
It's no friend of God.
That's right.
It's no friend of yours. I mean, just being sick doesn't draw you closer to God. It draws you closer to death.
Yeah. Amen.
And takes you away from your job and your wife or your husband or your children or your family, and you can't feed your family. Amen. And you get down near death's door. That's no friend. It's a plague. Yeah. I hate it. I hate sickness. Yeah. I'd rather have a rattlesnake in my bosom than to have a serious disease in my body. And I'm believing that God will take that rattlesnake of sickness out of your body
Amen.
Tonight
Amen.
And that you'll feel,
Glory.
You'll feel,
Glory.
You'll have the feeling of healing.
Amen.
We agree.
I didn't mean to get so loud, but I'm just burning up with this tonight.
Go.
Is so real. Hallelujah. And she felt in her body that she was healed of that plague. And Jesus felt something. He said, I feel power going out of me. Somebody touch me.
Glory.
But she only touched his clothes. He said, no, somebody got inside me.
Yes, yes.
Somebody touched me.
Glory.
He said, I feel the power. I feel the power go out of me. They said, well, what do you mean? Who touched you? The whole crowd is jostling up against you. He said, yeah, but this was a different touch.
Oh,
this
yes.
was a different
Glory
touch.
To
for somebody
to
touched me.
Yes.
I felt the power go out of me. And she, seeing that she was not hid, sprang forward trembling, said, Lord, I did it, but here's the reason why. And one of the gospels says, and she told him the cause, the purpose why she touched him. You know, you've got to have some purpose about you when you come to God. You just can't think, well, I'll just drift along here and somehow, some way, God will do this for me. It won't work like that. You need a purpose when you come to God. You need to focus on what you need God to do for you right now. I don't mean tomorrow. I mean now.
Yes. Amen.
And she felt it. Then he felt it. And then she came up and she said, I did it. You know, I really think she thought he had scolded her.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
She was very timid.
He said, daughter,
yes.
be of good cheer. Your faith
yes.
hath made you whole. And here's the revelation. I've just been dying to tell it. Oh, glory to God. You know, he made it clear it wasn't his clothes. He said, who touched me? But she said, if I can touch his clothes.
Oh, yes.
So he made it clear it wasn't his clothes. What are the clothes he's talking about? Whatever it was, he was in them. Now, he was in the clothes.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Notice she wasn't trying to touch Peter's clothes or John's clothes or John Smith's clothes. She wanted to touch something he was in. And also those clothes are wrapped around Jesus. She wanted to touch something that he was in and was wrapped around him. Now, who is Jesus in?
Ooh.
I know one thing, he's in Oral Roberts.
Whoa, 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 whoa.
Oh, I got this revelation. I got it. And I know I'm wrapped around Jesus. I'm just as much the clothes of Jesus tonight as those clothes were wrapped around Jesus' body when that little woman reached out and touched Jesus.
Lord,
and I tell you, Paul and Jan and I and every child of God on this earth, we are the garment of Jesus.
Yes.
We are the garment because Jesus is in us
yes.
and we're wrapped around
yes.
Jesus.
Whoa.
And you can get your healing right,
right
now.
Oh. Yeah. Oh, Lord, that's a rhema word.
Paul, you may have to take it right now. I tell you, I'm just...
That is a rainbow word, Brother Roberts.
That is
I hear that, and people can reach
what
out.
What did you
tonight.
Hear? Oh. What did you hear? Tell me. Tell
people
me.
Can touch
any of us.
We are his body.
Yes.
We are his
when
covered.
I touch you, that's his clothes, that's his garment, because he's in me,
Jesus.
And I'm wrapped around him. So I'm as much his garment as those clothes were. I never knew that my whole life.
When did that come?
It just came to me.
It.
Just a matter of days ago, and I've just been jumping up and down.
Glory.
You know, we are somebody. God's people. God's people have healing in them because
yes.
Jesus is in us and we're wrapped around him. And if you touch us or we touch you, we're really touching Jesus.
Yes.
We're reaching out to Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus.
Yes.
You know, I've been feeling all evening someone has been in an accident all down this side. Are you ready to be healed? Are you ready to touch the garment?
Jesus.
Why don't you just step up there and touch that hand right now? Just touch this hand. Touch it. Jesus, I feel in myself your healing power. Not my healing power, I don't have any, but I feel your healing power going through me into this injured body.
Oh, Jesus.
I feel someone's right shoulder is being loosed. Someone's neck has really been hurt. A garter. Put your hand on the garter now and swallow. Take it out.
Amen.
Praise God. Somebody's with a little child that's really suffering, and the family's been called in. And I want you people that I'm talking about, call in. Call that number on your screen. We want to know before the evening is over. There's a little child, and the family is called in. Little one, Talitha Kuma, I say unto thee, yes. Arise, arise.
Glory.
Little darling, it's time for you to get up. In Jesus' name, amen.
Oh, Brother Robert.
Amen.
Brother Robert. The calls are coming in, but the thought just hit me as you were giving that tremendous revelation. Jesus told us, greater works than these shall ye do.
And he said that the Holy Spirit shall be in you. And shall be with you.
Yes.
So we're as much the garment of Jesus as those clothes.
Lord have mercy.
She wasn't interested in the clothes, really, because he said she touched me.
Yes. Yes.
The clothes were incidental.
Have you ever felt the virtue go out of your body, Dr. Robert?
Oh, every time. Sometimes my eyes cross.
Yeah.
This man that was paralyzed, that whole story wasn't told. His when he got up from that floor, that was a miracle.
Oh, yes.
And this side of his mouth.
Yeah.
I don't know if you remember when he first tried to talk when he couldn't.
Yes, yes.
That man felt. Also, he had come there. He had a purpose.
Touch the garment.
Yes.
What I feel is, and please don't take this wrong, the people of God are the one Jesus is in, and we're the only ones in the world wrapped around him. And we're his garment. Now, I want you to realize we're not important in ourselves. We'll tell you that. But the real important people on this earth are the ones who have the Jesus of Nazareth in them, with all of his saving and healing and delivering and supplying power. All of it is in us.
Yes. Oh, Lord.
And your little simple faith turn loose to Jesus, and my little simple faith turn loose to Jesus, we'll have the feeling of healing.
Yes.
Amen.
You know what, Brother Roberts, hundreds of needs are just pouring in on the telephones right now, and I know you will lead us, but just before you do, how many in this room need a definite healing touch in your body tonight? Would you just lift your hand? You know, I'm going to lift my hand. I need a touch
from the Lord. We all
need a touch,
Paul.
In my body. I've been going through a few things myself. But would you... Oh, I know it'll be hard.
Would you let me pray for you?
Yes.
Oh.
Would you stand up?
Of course.
Yes, sir.
Now,
yes, sir.
I have to be very careful when the power comes on me strong. I touch you too strongly. I don't mean to. But it's hard to hold it back.
Praise the Lord.
And I hope you don't mind.
Hey, whatever the Lord has for me, I...
Lucy!
Lord of them.
Jan, stand up. Do you mind if I touch the way I feel? Lucy!
Thank you, Jesus.
And let her go.
Thank
Praise you, Lord Jesus.
Hold up.
praise you.
Oh,
Jesus.
Glory to God.
Lord, I receive your touch.
Now, I want you to touch me. Now, Paul, I want you to touch me like you mean business.
Amen.
Jesus is in you, and you're wrapped around him.
Amen.
Is that right?
Indeed, I got that.
I've been fighting a thing back here, trying to attack this part of my body.
Amen.
When I get through praying, that thing hits me, I want it gone.
Amen. Amen.
Stretch your hand.
Oral Roberts has prayed for you hundreds of times. Now let us reach our hands out, and in the name of Jesus, we agree right now that healing virtue flows this moment into this physical body in the same way, Lord.
Put your hand right there, right there, right there.
Virtue went out of
you
to that precious woman. We agree in the name of Jesus that healing power and virtue flows this moment into this body. We agree and receive.
Everybody start moving. That's been prayed for in a way that you couldn't move.
Praise.
Glory to God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus.
Oh,
let me tell you, when your hand went down my body, I felt that like an electrical current going. The feeling of healing. Look at those hands.
We are his body.
Jesus is in you.
Oh, Lord, I've never thought of it that way, or I've never heard that word.
Well, you just touched someone that like an electrical current went through me, and it wasn't any electricity, it was Jesus' healing power.
Glory to God. Glory to God.
Glory to God.
You know, just before we pray for these many that are looking in tonight and believing the Lord for a miracle, could you go back and tell us what are one or two or three of the stories that stand out in your mind when you've witnessed?
I'll just tell you one right quick because I don't want to take the time.
We saw one on the air tonight.
Listen, I took my car to the garage yesterday, and the assistant manager of the auto parts and all knew me. And when I drove in, everybody just came out, including the owner, and they began to tell me about healings, you know, through my ministry. And I thought, dear God, what is going on here? I just brought my car to be fixed. And this man said, 3 days ago, my daddy was dying. No. At the time I prayed, he had 3 days to live. The doctors thought he would die in 72 hours because he had bone cancer. And he said, when you prayed, since I was just a little boy, my daddy lived 20 years and preached the gospel.
Oh, my.
And he said, brother, when you need your car fixed, you drive your car in here. That's all the story you... I tell you, I stood there and I wanted to bawl. You know, I wanted to cry, Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. Glory to God.
Tell that one little story about how when you were watching on TV.
Oh, but my face too. I wanted to tell that one again.
Yes.
But when I was just a teenager, I used to watch Dr. Roberts' program on Sunday afternoon in Columbus, Georgia.
That was on TV?
Oh, yes. And I never would miss it. It was so just incredible to me to see those miracles. And I remember a little boy that came up that his eyes were completely crossed. And I mean, you could see them on camera. You could see his little eyes crossed. And Dr. Roberts took those thick, thick glasses off. And then he just laid hands on him and prayed for him. And just as it was just the most incredible thing to see, those little eyes just straighten right up and look into the camera. I remember I just fell on my face there and cried. And my dad had Dr. Roberts then to Columbus, Georgia for a big healing crusade and just turned that city upside down, Columbus, Georgia. But about 2 years ago, I had a lump come up on my face right here. And it just started growing, and it got hard, and it was just growing. I went to 3 different doctors, and they said, yes, you have a lump on your face.
Yeah, thanks.
And they really didn't know what it was. I went to, I won't say who, but 3 different ones, and they verified that I had a lump on my face. And one day, I just felt like I should call Dr. Roberts. So I just called him, and sweet as he is and as busy as he was, he took time to pray for me one day. And so that night, as Paul and I went, he took me out to dinner because it really had been bothering me and hurting and everything. And Dr. Roberts had just prayed for me. Paul got home and took me out to dinner. And just as we were sitting down to eat dinner in a restaurant, all of a sudden, my face just opened up this side and began to drain. I had to run to the restroom and sit in there maybe 15 minutes as something drained, just completely drained out of my face. And the lump was gone, and it's been gone to this day.
Thank you,
and,
Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus. And this just happened, what, a year or so ago.
Yes.
And so the miracle power, Jesus is in you. The garments never change. And I reached out to touch your garment.
you remind me of something. Today I got a letter that Evelyn handed me. And this man started out saying, Brother Roberts, I just heard that the healing ministry has been renewed in you. He said, the first thought I had, God is up to something. He's had you take all those years to build and establish Oral Roberts University. Or are you now is to stay until Jesus comes?
Yes.
And he said, now he's released you to go back in the healing ministry. And he says, I believe it means that God's people are going to feel in them the healing power flowing through them. And there's going to be a whole new healing wave sweep the earth.
Glory.
I thought, you know, what if he's right? What if he's right?
I believe he is.
What if he's right?
Yes.
What if we are? What if we are the garment of Jesus? That means it's not just Oral Roberts or Paul Crouch. It's every child of God.
Yes.
Jesus
yes.
is in us, and we're wrapped around him, and we can touch one another and be healed in Jesus' name.
Amen. 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 You know what? I feel like some of you have already been touched and healed. And others are wanting to get your request in. Let's have Vern sing one more song. Surely the presence of the Lord is
get
in
to the phone,
this
Paul.
Place.
Yeah.
But get to
Paul
the phone. Right. Give us a testimony if you've received that touch, if you feel that power, the healing feeling. I think
the feeling of healing.
The feeling of healing. I think you've coined a new term there.
Well, the Lord just gave it to me.
Do it tonight. Let us know. Phone those testimonies in, and then we'll have a few more minutes here as Vern sings for you to get your prayer requests in. And then I know Dr. Roberts will lead us in a great additional prayer for all of you that are still waiting for the Lord to touch you tonight. One of the sweetest songs you'll ever hear, surely the presence of the Lord is in this place. Do you feel him here? I do.
In the midst of his children, the Lord said he'd be. It doesn't take very many, it can be just two or three. And I feel that same sweet spirit that I felt on. Surely I can say I've been with the Lord. Surely the Lord is in this place. I can feel His mighty power. I see glory on each face. Oh, There's a holy assurance as God's glory fills this place. I've touched the hem of His garment. I can almost see His face, and my heart is overflowing with the fullness of the joy I know without a doubt that I've been with the Lord. The Lord is in this place. I can feel His mighty power. I see glory on His face. The Lord is in this place.
Brother Roberts, I know I speak for many, many, many out there who couldn't be more delighted that the Lord has released you to once again really move out amongst the people and touch them with the healing power of Jesus. I'm so happy to hear that.
Paul, I'd really appreciate it if you all would pray for the Meldeland three-day crusade that Richard and I are going to conduct.
Yes, sir.
The last 2 days of this month and the first day of November, Friday, Saturday, and Sunday. And it's right across from Disneyland. I guess everybody knows where it is.
Anaheim.
And I've never seen the healing power on two young men that I right now. Benny Hinn,
yes,
is so anointed. I was recently with him in a crusade, and I tell you, I cried, and I fell of the power. And my son Richard. Richard's faith has exploded. The anointing is on him. And when we to know that God raised up a son for me to be with me and to really, in effect, take charge of ORU in good hands. And although I'm not giving up ORU and I'm not leaving ORU, but I get to go.
More.
And Richard gets to go too, and we're going to meet in Meldyland for all the partners and friends of Southern California and the nation.
Now, for the radio audience that couldn't see that, it's November the
it's October 30, 31, and November 1
okay.
At Meldyland across from Disneyland in Anaheim, California.
Right. Many will be there.
Pardon
7
me?
7 o'clock.
It's, I'd say, if you want a seat, about 7 o'clock would be a good time to get there. Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
Let's rejoice because Ray in Cincinnati, Ohio just gave his heart to Jesus tonight. Mira from Corona, California, 57. Jason was healed of Hodgkin's disease from Las Vegas, Nevada. Glory to God. Look, the testimonies are starting to roll in. Praise God, praise God. Said our medical bill was miraculously paid for, and our house did not have to go up for sale.
Mm.
Beautiful, beautiful testimonies. Mm. Just several little messages to you, Brother Roberts. I'll just give them to you as you leave after a while. More prayer requests. Just so many calling just to say, tell Brother Roberts
yes.
Hello, and we
yes.
rejoice that he's
yes. Yes.
being allowed by the Lord to move into the healing ministry with more time. Just so many. I'll give them to you.
And I tell you, if you want to be prayed for in healing, get one of those ORU students hold of you.
Amen.
And you'll think someone got hold of you from the Lord. Healing's all over that campus.
Amen. Well, Jan,
listen,
honey, share a few.
Don't let me dominate all the time.
No,
you got others here. I'll just move.
We got all evening.
Have we?
Yes, my Lord. I'll keep you here as long as you'll stay.
Everybody on the whole channel.
God's people own the whole station. We'll just stay on as long as we want to.
Well, I don't want to take up all the time, you know, so.
Will you now promise me you'll really seriously pray about doing a little weekly Bible study of some kind, right? How many of y'all would like to have Brother Roberts just kind of visit with you on a weekly basis? And
well, you know,
just
that just might be all right.
Wouldn't that be nice?
I think it'd be wonderful.
This might be all right. You're probably talking about soon.
I'd say, yes. How about tomorrow morning?
We could take tomorrow. We have tomorrow.
Just tell us those wonderful little stories, like the little woman with the issue of blood and how the Lord touched her, and, you know, that's how.
My Lord, I could talk till Jesus comes.
That's kind of what we had in mind.
Well, my goodness,
Jan,
that's a great honor.
Share some of the prayer needs, and then let's have Brother Roberts just lead us in a final word here for all of these many, many requests that have come in. Mm-hmm.
Here's someone with cancer. Dr. Roberts needs a healing. Someone with a stroke. Insomnia. Here's someone has problems with their liver and her back. The bones, something's wrong with her bones. Has had a nervous breakdown. Here's another one that has cancer.
I would like to give a word of encouragement to the person who's been injured that we prayed for, and to you that's gathered around that little child, and the one with the very, very bad goiter. The things that we mentioned, something is going on in you right now. Right now. And don't neglect it. Call the number. When you feel it's beginning to happen, get encouragement. Get these prayer partners in there. They're great. I've been out here many times, and always just scores of them in there praying, believing God. And call that number on your screen, because it's really your time to be healed.
Amen. 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 Here's a lady, says the doctors ordered her into the hospital and she doesn't want to go.
Father, we thank you for your healing power. We thank you for medical science, for doctors, for hospitals and nurses and those people doing their best.
Yes.
And now then we look to God for divine healing, for supernatural, miraculous intervention.
Yes.
And as this woman touched the hem of your garment and actually touched you, Jesus, we reach through the clothes, through the outward man, and we touch you, Jesus.
Yes.
And we believe that you feel the power going out of you, for we feel the feeling of healing now.
Amen.
In the name of Jesus, receive it from the Lord. Amen.
Amen.
And amen.
Amen. Praise God. Brother Roberts, I want you to stay 4 more minutes. And I want you, roll the monitor over here, Danny, would you please? I want Brother Roberts to see this beautiful video that we've just done with some old tapes we found of Brother Jack Holcomb. And Roger McDuff has recorded a new album as a tribute to Jack. You knew Brother Holcomb,
didn't
you?
Oh, I knew Jack Holcomb well and loved his singing, yes.
Yeah. There was a touch and an anointing upon Brother Jack.
Yes, of course, Roger, you know.
Sounds a lot like him.
Roger's special.
Yeah.
Yes.
All right. Now, one final request. You literally have planted the first money. I have not received one penny yet for the People's Republic of China. Will you let me hold these very bills to the 1st of November?
Sure.
And I want to lay them out before the Lord.
Yes.
On that night that we really speak to the partners about that station. And you and Evelyn will have planted the very first seed.
Thank you, Lord.
In the People's Republic of China. And I'll hold these very bills out and we'll lay them out before the Lord that night.
Amen.
And I know God's people are going to respond as always as we go to another whole nation with the good news. Watch your screens carefully. And this is a little different for us at TBN, but this is Brother Jack Holcomb and Roger McDuff together.
Of God is greater far than summer bend can ever turn.
it goes beyond the highest star and reaches to the lowest hell. If you think I am,
thank you, Bob Popma, and all the crew. And I guess my son, Paul Jr., had a little hand in telling that little story. As Jack Holcomb, the scripture says, he being dead yet speaketh. And to think that we actually could put Roger McDuff and Jack together in a little duet here in the 20th century. I guess Jack's been in heaven how many years? Back in the 60s, I think.
If I do that little half hour a week that you talked to me about, I could see cutting in from the big tent, from the healing line, and from the messages. And
y'all think that'd be a good idea?
We just saw, we just pulled out, something happened April 12, 1956, a girl, 20 years old. At 15 months, the furnace had exploded in the basement and took all of her hearing. Mm-hmm. And after she graduated from the high school for the deaf in Indianapolis, they brought her to my crusade. And there it is, it's taped, and she's hearing for the first time, and she's crying, and now she has a great family. I was thinking about cutting her in while I was talking.
I would love to do that.
You know,
you've got all those old videos,
yes,
don't you?
Oh, yes, we've got all from 1954 right on up through 1968.
On probably what, 16 millimeter film?
Well,
or
it's
one of the
old black and white film.
Yeah.
But I tell you, it doesn't make any difference what color it is. It's the power of God.
Glory. Y'all agree? Shall Brother Roberts do this? Oh, we think it'd be a wonderful idea, and we'll work with you, Brother Roberts. Let's just tell Oral Roberts, thank you for being here, ministering to us tonight, loving us, touching
us, we love
bringing
y'all.
The healing virtue of Jesus.
And I can't wait until we have our 1,000 full-power stations trying to broadcast all over the earth.
Yes.
1,000. You know, I whisper in your ear what the Spirit told me.
Yes, I know.
Maybe 2 years ago. It's coming, brother.
Well, we're at 319 right now.
Well, we only have 681 to go.
But 152 are under construction and 39 more are being filed for. So there's another almost 200.
We're nearly half.
One today.
We've come further than we were when we began.
Amen, amen, amen. Let's tell Brother Roberts one more. Take our love to Evelyn, and we love you all, and come as often as you can.
And join me in prayer. I have a vow. By December 31, 1992, that all bills were paid, we're totally out of debt with ORU, and never be in debt again forever.
Good for you.
A vow to God, a vow.
We agree in
be the
name
garment of Jesus.
Jesus. We agree that every obligation, Oral Roberts Ministries, ORU, anything, we agree that by the December 31st date, it'll be absolutely free and clear. We receive it and command it so in Jesus' name.
Amen.
And everybody said,
Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Oh, I'm glory. Even now. Praise God.
Let me get your microphone. Vern Jackson's going to bless us one more time with that beautiful song,
we love you,
Daystar.
I mean, you're special.
Amen.
Amen.
Darkness, haunted by 2,000 years.
memories of past defeat. Then I see you standing near me, Lord, shining with compassion in your
Thank you, Vern. I love that song. In fact, yes, Jan just reminded me that will be on the beautiful Christmas album that will be out the first week in November during our week of Praise-a-thon.
Absolutely beautiful.
And all the old favorites. What? Silent Night, Holy Night.
Oh, Holy Night.
Oh, Holy Night. Hark the Herald Angels Sing. Just all the old Christmas favorites. But then this song, which I guess really isn't technically a Christmas carol, but how can you beat it? Day Star, Shine Down on Us. And it'll be one of the beautiful, beautiful songs that will be on that Christmas album. It's not available yet, dear friends. Now, some are calling in and saying, where do I get that? Well, remember, we gave away the Roger McDuff album with the Jack Holcomb little duet all the month of September. Where were you? Why didn't you write to me and ask for it then? Well, now that month has passed, but if you'll hurry to your Christian bookstore, it will soon be available in the Christian bookstore, so you'll be able to still pick it up there. We do not have any more, dear friends. It is long gone here. Do I understand that Babushka just might make a special cameo appearance later, much later tonight? I heard that little rumor.
Tim Penland is a fan of Babushka's, we just found out. And he has asked by special request that Babushka be here tonight.
I see.
So we'll see if we can find her. She's very independent, you know.
I know.
She wants to come, she will. If she doesn't, there's no way to get her on here.
Well, I think if moms and dads, maybe you'll let the boys and girls stay up till a little later tonight. Now, I know it's pretty late back on the East Coast, but they may have to catch it on the rerun tomorrow afternoon. But Babushka is a little orphan girl that came to live at our house many years ago.
She's very streetwise before she got
She was a very naughty little girl. She was abused, and she was very... She was what?
Never mind.
No,
that was for Tim.
That needn't be said. She was She was rescued by the Crouch family, and she has found a home with us, and we have tried to bring her up in the fear and admonition of the Lord, but that is not easy with Babushka. I understand she will also be a guest artist on the new Romper Stomper. What is that name of that new program?
I don't know. We've got to get that.
The ever-loving...
Radical romping,
devil stomping,
Bible
talking, faith walking,
curtain climbers,
kids club, or something like that. And Lori and Matt and I think even the dog Judah and
Judah's gonna be on.
Babushka will all be and a whole bunch of little kids.
And Kalen,
of course. Oh, Kalen, he'll steal the show. But we have never really done a TV program for the real little set, you know, the little preschoolers. And so if you've got a preschooler, a beautiful new program is being developed and will begin taping next week. But let's say hello to a dear old friend. And he has a new friend that he wants to introduce to us tonight. You have seen and been blessed by the great testimony of Tim Penland a number of times. He is the president of the Penland Company, currently continues to develop the marketing and the distribution for your film, China Cry. By the way, Tim, New Year's Eve, for the first time, television debut worldwide, China Cry. It will be our gift to you. It's your film. You paid for it. You financed it. And so this New Year's Eve. Tim, of course, is no stranger to the motion picture field. Many of you remember the great award-winning film Chariots of Fire back in 1981. Tim was involved in the successful marketing and distribution of this highly acclaimed Chariots of Fire, which won 4 Academy Awards and was proclaimed Best Picture of the Year. Since then, Tim's been involved with a number of other films, television projects, including the highly acclaimed The Mission, which was nominated for 7 Academy Awards, winning an Oscar for cinematography. I'll let him do the honors of introducing his special friend, but let's just say hello, Tim Penland, Burbank, California. Beautiful downtown Burbank. Is it still there?
Yes, it is. And it's getting more beautiful every day.
Really?
Used to be a sleepy little town, but now it's really thriving, and we have lots of restaurants, and, you know, Johnny Carson used to put Burbank down, but he can't anymore.
Yeah. Well, myself, I'll stay here in Orange County, I think, but... you know, beautiful downtown Burbank is still there, dear friends, for those of you who want to go see it. Would you do us the honor of introducing our special new friend tonight?
Yes, as a matter of fact, we're sitting here awfully cozy on this bench. It's a little...
This is called the love seat, so for two gentlemen, that isn't too appropriate.
We feel very... Your face is turning red.
Yes, Tim. Why is that?
Listen, I'm excited about what the Lord has done, you know. We lost one of our great friends here recently,
yes.
You know, about a year ago, Jimmy Collier died, and how the Lord used Jimmy Collier through his life, but he died pretty young, you know.
Yes.
We were kind of dismayed by that, and I remember you, Jan, you really were shaken up. Matt was shaken. But God is faithful. And interestingly enough, the reason Tim is here, I believe, and I don't want to embarrass him by saying this,
Tim
Mashler, is that 8 years ago, Tim is a very successful screenwriter for television. 8 years ago, he found the Lord. And I'll let him tell his story. But I really believe Tim is God's answer today for the void that Jim Collier left. He's not a Jim Collier in the same sense of the word. But Tim, it's exciting to see what God has done in his life, and I'd like for Tim to tell us what happened maybe 8 years ago.
Let me just add real quickly, because this dear brother has quite a pedigree, I guess, in this very creative field of writing for the screen. He was head writer on Crazy Like a Fox, remember that? Jan will remember that series. He has written for many notable shows such as Magnum P.I., Knott's Landing, Medical Story, Hawaii 5-0, Police Story, Matt Houston, Starsky and Hutch, recently Pros and Cons. He is currently working in a partnership with the Penland Company, and I know they are bubbling over and brimming over with ideas. You know what, Tim, just before we pull out of Tim a word of testimony here, something just really hit me as you showed me this list.
Mm-hmm.
First of all, the good news, what? In video rentals, what? China Cry is still number one.
Still number one.
Hey. How many weeks?
Amen. Now, months.
How many months?
Since January.
Virtually the whole year now.
Yeah.
But you know what struck me is on number two is still A Thief in the Night that
mm-hmm.
was produced.
Yeah, Mark IV.
20 years ago.
20 years ago.
Number three, Distant Thunder, Mark IV Pictures. That was done many years ago. Image of the Beast, Mark IV. Hell's Bells, The Dangers of Rocket. That slipped out there. Well, it's number five, folks. Sorry, there it is. There it is. The Prodigal Planets, number six. The point I'm making is these fine motion pictures, I mean, Thief in the Night has mm-hmm. been a favorite of what? Mm-hmm. New Year's Eve showings in churches for years
yeah.
and years and years.
Great
and years.
Evangelistic tool.
Yes, has been the means of leading many to Christ, but where are the new ones? I mean,
yeah.
China Cry is the only new film on here, which means, if I'm reading this thing correctly, there is a terrible, terrible vacuum here.
Absolutely.
That hasn't been filled by
Absolutely.
The church and by the body of Christ. So what we want to have you pray with us about,
Amen.
Dear friends, is this. First of all, the good news. The investment. Are you ready for some good news? Wake up. The investment you made in China Cry has been returned. We have
Amen.
The money back through film rentals, through distribution, home videos, through foreign distribution, all of these other means. And, of course, we've used it as a love gift in December last year. We used it for a little mini-thon. God has wonderfully, and you have beautifully, returned those funds. So, Tim, we are ready. And, Madam Program Director, could you use some new made-for-TV motion pictures?
Do you know, I think that's what we get more requests for than any other thing, is when are you going to show motion pictures?
Yeah.
And several years ago, we bought all that Billy Graham had and have the right to show those, and we did on Monday nights. But he hasn't been making any for what, 10, 12 years?
You went through those
quite
fast, didn't you?
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. So we just need motion pictures that just uplift a good moral story.
Well, we get a lot of requests. People are saying, where is your next film? When is the next film? And, of course, I think we are behind time. And that's why God has provided Tim as a tremendous helpmate, because in
Amen.
The beginning was the Word, and it starts with the Word.
Right.
Tim Meschler. My, what a pedigree here. I guess the thing that I am most interested in is how would a guy that is this successful with all of these many, many credits to his name out of old Hollywood, as we say, come to know Jesus Christ as his Savior?
Well, Paul, I've heard a lot of testimonies on this program over the years, and when I came to the Lord, many who have come to the Lord have given their testimonies on the show here, have come from those dire circumstances, have been in the pit and at the end. And when I came to the Lord, I was, at least I thought, I was at the top. I was at the top of my career, and things were just rolling right along. And I was in a meeting one day, and my wife called, kind of a trembly voice, and I thought there was something wrong, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And she said, I just want to say I'm born again.
Just like that.
Just like that.
Did you even understand what that term meant?
Vaguely.
Mm-hmm.
Really, just vaguely.
Okay.
And I said, well, great, honey, that's fine. Boom. You know? Well, that started me on an odyssey. I saw a tremendous transformation in her. And quite quickly, after reading the Bible and talking to people and praying and so forth, I came to the Lord. And honestly, when I came to the Lord, I thought the Lord was getting something pretty special. You know? I mean, I'm at the top. I can just kind of keep rolling with this thing, you know? But that's not what he had in mind at all. And quite quickly, the show that I was working on that was so successful was canceled. I thought I'd just keep rolling. But as my agent would offer me things or things that were being offered to me, I'd go ahead and take them with a standard, a godly standard, at least as I knew it as a new believer, you know, when I was excited and so on. And so I was writing, but every year, the things that I would accept, they just kept going down in number. And the Lord was pruning me and honing me, and I didn't know it at the time. It really got to the point where I decided, okay, I'm not going to do any more secular television at all. I'm going to come up with godly ideas, and that's all I'm going to do.
And that went over like a lead balloon in Hollywood, I'm sure,
didn't
it?
Oh, yeah, exactly. A lot of turndowns. Still got the meetings, but still many turndowns. And so I said, okay, I won't go to any more meetings. I'll just sit home at my computer and write. Well, what I discovered was that it was my heart that was still wrong. As I was writing, what I was looking for was, if I could write that godly thing, then I would be blessed with all my problems taken care of, rather than seek ye first the kingdom of God and everything will be added unto you. And so I just decided, well, all these doors are closing. I must be called into the mission field.
Yeah,
really, seriously.
And Africa, here I come.
Yeah. Mexico it was, actually. And, I mean, I speak Spanish, so it must be Mexico. Mm-hmm. But that was the point where the long arm of Tim Pendland came in. Why don't you tell that part of it?
Well, you know, what happened was we were doing a show for another ministry, or helping develop a show for another ministry, and I was interviewing writers. And a lot of the top Hollywood writers were sending in their resumes. Well, I got his resume in, and I looked at it and thought, boy, this is great. About the time I asked him in for an interview, his resume was withdrawn. And I know now the reason. He had just confirmed that he was going full-time in the ministry, and he says, I'm not interested in anything in this. Well, I picked up the phone, and normally, you know, you would say, well, we'll move on to the next guy. I didn't know what was behind the scenes. I picked up the phone, and about 5 minutes on the phone with him, I could tell the Lord had touched him in a special way. There's a special gift that God has given this guy. And I said, look, we need you. I don't know of any other Christian writers that really have the Spirit of Christ in you that have this kind of experience. There are a lot of writers that don't have any experience that love the Lord, and there's nothing wrong with that. So that began a two-month period of concentrated hour upon hour sitting in the office of me trying to talk him out of this, going to the mission field. I said, look, the Lord has given you 20 years of experience. Do you think he wants to throw that away and now you're going to be out digging ditches? Nothing wrong with digging ditches.
Or wells on the mission field.
Or wells on the mission field. I said, he's given you this gift of writing. Finally, after much prayer, the door of the mission offer closed.
Really?
And what became exciting was that Tim and I began to work on, and he has been getting up in the morning. He is excited because what he's really wanted to do was write things that had the Spirit of Christ in them. Not that they would be preachy, but that would have first entertaining and the Spirit of Christ. He wakes up at 4:00 in the morning, you know, just can't wait to get to his computer, and the Lord has laid in our lap a number of things. But I am so excited about what God does. This is all God's doing.
Tim, can you write the Battle of Armageddon with the Antichrist coming apart at the seams, with blood flowing to the horses' bridles? Can we just scare the hell out of everybody?
All we need is $20 million.
$20 million. Can we do it for about $500,000? Seriously, there you have them. Thief mm-hmm. in the night, mm-hmm. a great prophetic message mm-hmm. on the second coming of mm-hmm. Christ. There is a great cry,
a hunger.
Heart cry, and yes. a hunger, not only in the body of Christ, but I think in the secular
yeah.
world out there for
yeah.
what's going to happen. You know, every year,
yeah.
you know, Jean Dixon gives us her,
yeah.
you know,
predictions.
20 predictions for the coming year,
yeah.
and the psychics and the soothsayers and the, you know, wizards and the mediums, they all have their, and for some strange reason,
mm-hmm.
in those ridiculous birdcage liner newspapers that are mm-hmm. on the supermarkets as you check out, people buy those things. They're fascinated.
They want
to know what's going to happen in the future. And hey, this book tells
That's
us
it.
What's going to happen
exactly.
in the future.
The script's already been written.
The script is written, and Tim, we've got to memorialize some of these great events, these future events that mm-hmm. Daniel talks about, and Revelation talks about, and Ezekiel, and Isaiah, and all the great prophets and sages.
Make them live.
Mm. And yes. make them come alive in a soul-winning
yes.
format. I don't want films that just entertain or that tickle you somewhere. I want them to get under people's skin and pull them into the kingdom of Christ.
Amen. Otherwise, you're wasting your time.
Exactly, exactly. So
here's a thought. What if we did this? What if we asked the audience what they would like? What if we put up a couple of scenarios? Now, let me tell you what we've been working on, too. So we've been working on a package of things called the Heroes of the Faith. We're convinced that people get inspired by true life stories. Well, there are some great true life stories out there right now that would just knock your hat in the creek, as they say in Texas. And people could be inspired and uplifted by them. Some from the Old Testament, which we're excited about.
Yeah.
Some from the New Testament, but also some that are just recent, you know, 20 years ago, about people maybe that have passed on. That's an exciting challenge, and we feel God has laid that as a burden on us. Mm-hmm. But you've had this burden about the end times. Maybe what would be good would be to ask the audience, because really these partners out there are the ones that made China Cry successful. Let's face it.
Hey, yeah. Great idea. We've got an hour left if we want it. Yeah. Come on. Yeah. Give me your script idea.
Yeah.
Go to the phone right now and tell us what you feel in your heart and in your spirit would, number one, be a great soul-winning tool.
Right.
Number two, would edify and lift the body of Christ.
Right.
And would just be the thing that you would like to see on your Trinity. This is your network, dear friends. It really, really is. Jan and I are just stewards of this work in ministry. And again and again and again, how many times, honey, have we looked in the lens of each camp and said, partners, help us. Give us your thoughts. Give us your heart. Give us your ideas. Tell us what you feel the Lord is speaking in your spirit. And I want to tell you.
There's wisdom in numbers. There's wisdom in numbers.
Safety. There's Proverbs
safety.
Says there's safety. In a multitude of counselors, there is safety.
Exactly.
And so again and again, we have gotten direction. I'll tell you, there is great. What is the word I'm looking for here? There is great safety, as the scripture says, in the collective
wisdom
and knowledge of the body
imparts,
of Christ.
That God imparts.
Right.
Through.
If you know, if somebody comes and says, Paul, the Lord's telling me so and so and so and so and so, sometimes I say, well, dear brother, dear sister, when the Lord tells me the same thing, well, I'll agree with you on
Amen.
That.
Amen. Yeah.
Or somebody else.
Yeah.
Two people.
Or in the mouth of two or three witnesses, the scripture says, let a thing be established.
Yeah.
So, but so many times, that beautiful body of Christ out there that loves TBN, and that is, you are TBN, really, has given us direction and wisdom and guidance and prayer. And so, hey, for the next, that's a great idea, Tim. I should have thought of that.
Yeah.
Let's hear from you all tonight, and we'll
I think we'll hear the Spirit of Christ in what they'll respond.
Yes.
I believe we'll hear
Absolutely.
God.
Absolutely.
Can we read you something fantastic about China Cry?
Tim Penland found this book, I guess, and got it down to me. It's called Hollywood versus America.
Yeah.
And Tim, tell us a tiny bit about Michael Medved.
This is Michael Medved. Now, Michael is, I think, a modern-day Jeremiah. He's a devout Jew. He loves the same God that we love. I love the guy personally. But he's a film critic, and he's on PBS. Jan read one of his letters a year ago on here, but he was contracted to write this book. Well, this is the hottest book going right now. He's been on every network. Michael was on with David Brinkley the other morning, with Charlton Heston, David Brinkley, and Richard Dreyfuss debating this book. And they brought they thought that they were going to put him down, but every time he goes on, it's unbelievable what's happening. So the Hollywood versus America.
Okay, in a nutshell, what's Michael telling us in this book?
Well, he's telling us that Hollywood is out of touch with America, and that Hollywood is not making the kind of films that America really wants and needs. He uses China Cry as the prime example, not prompted by us. This is purely the Lord working through a devout Jew as the prime example of a very successful thing that's happened when sincere people, not Hollywood people, but sincere people get together and do it. The film partner, the partners, the TBN partners can glory in that because of the recognition that book is getting right now in all the media and because of the example he uses there.
Okay, Jan, read the little section
it's
where
beautiful.
He speaks to
China Cry.
China Cry.
It says, one pioneering production along these lines has already achieved impressive success. And along these lines, what he's talking about is those of you that have good moral stories, uplifting good morals, go out there and make them. That's what he's encouraging mm-hmm. people to do. So he says, one pioneering production along these lines has already achieved impressive success. China Cry, 1990, financed by the Trinity Broadcasting Network partners and starring the gifted Asian-American performers Julia Nixon Soul and Russell Wong. No one would describe this earnest low-budget film as an unqualified artistic triumph, but its emotional impact is undeniable. Both times I've watched it, audience members wept openly at its true story of a young mother, Nora Lamb, who undergoes a religious conversion while suffering brutal persecution at the hands of the Chinese communist. The biggest surprise about this offbeat production involves its remarkable performance at the box office. Without well-known stars or any promotion budget to speak of, China Cry drew an amazing response from the public and averaged more than $6,000 per screening in its first month of release. This means that in the multiplex theaters where it played alongside major studio releases, it easily clobbered films such as Rocky V. Did we clobber Rocky V? That took quite a bit to clobber Rocky V, didn't it? Or Goodfellas. Good yeah. for that.
Yeah.
Thank you, partners, for overdoing that one. And its producer and director. Our Predator 2.
Oh, that was a real winner.
Yes, really. Oh, brother. The picture ultimately played in some 900 theaters, sold over 200,000 video units, and earned more than double its initial production cost of $5 million.
There's a little inaccuracy
yeah,
there, dear friends.
There is an explanation. I'll give you that.
Okay.
Okay. Much of the credit for its success goes to its co-producer, Tim Penland.
They gave me that credit. Now,
well, I'm not sure that. I think all the credit should go to the
TV
partners.
I had nothing to do with this writing.
I see.
A well-respected Hollywood insider who resigned his position as a consultant at Universal in the midst of the controversy over The Last Temptation of Christ. Thank you. Everyone bows
no
to you
to
for
me.
That. You had to do
you
it.
You had to get out of that, I know. That. Yes, sir.
Penland notes that China Cry produced and distributed for a mere fraction of the cost of Last Temptation of Christ and with none of the attendant national publicity still reached significantly larger audiences in both its theatrical and video releases than did Last Temptation of Christ. Can you just
Amen.
Kiss the Lord right on
Amen.
Each cheek for that? I love that. If future undertakings originating in the religious community manage to achieve comparable success, the major studios, and this was the whole point, will be forced to take notice and perhaps to make room for similar projects under their aegis.
Mm.
Very good article Amen. On China wow. Cry. Thank you, Michael.
Do you suppose
it's
you
a great
could
book. It really is. It's well worth reading.
And
it's
you're still going to try and get Michael down here some night,
yes,
aren't you?
Yes, he's agreed to. And I told him about Jan holding the book up the other night. He was thrilled. And I said, she held it up on. And I said, it'll be interesting to watch a little spike in your sales, Michael. But he said he would love to come down. He's under such demand that his schedule is booked up solid. But within the next couple of weeks, if you have an opening, he would love to come down and talk.
And this is Yom Kippur, and he's very...
Right.
Yeah, he's
but you'd love him. He's a brilliant guy, and he'll just thrill you.
Do you want me to tell you a funny little story that happened the other night because it's Rosh Hashanah?
Okay, Rosh Hashanah, as all of you know, is popularly known as the Feast of Trumpets, and many Bible scholars do believe that since Christ fulfilled all the other feasts perfectly, that he will also fulfill this. Now, we have the Feast of Tabernacles that follows, so this is the next to the last of the great Jewish feasts. And many believe, and personally I do too, that Christ,
all the others.
Yes, will come in the rapture as a fulfillment of Rosh Hashanah or the Feast of Trumpets. This occurred, what, just a few days ago?
It started last Sunday night, I believe it was.
September the 29th.
29th or 7th or something. Anyway, we were down here working, a group of us.
In this studio.
In this studio, right here. We were getting all the new plants and everything on the set. And this monitor over here has the time on it so that it gives the time 11:55, 11:56, and it just keeps showing on this monitor over here what time it is on a digital clock. So we were working around in the flowers, and one of our guards, Fred, who is just the sweetest guy in the world, he picks up the guests, just the sweetest little perfect little Christian person was around here with us, and he was helping us. And there was a whole bunch of us that are, you know, working around here, and so all of a sudden, and there were two little prayer partners back there in the back. So we were waving at them, we were working, putting flowers around, and all of a sudden I looked at the clock over there, the digital clock, and it was 12:06. Rosh Hashanah had begun. The Feast of Trumpets had happened. So I turned around and I looked back there in the phone booth, and those two little partners were gone. And I looked around and Fred was gone. And I screamed, "Fred!" Just that loud. And he came running out from behind the curtain. He said, "What? What?" I said, "Oh, thank God."
My dear,
you're still here.
Do you have the assurance that if you died tonight?
That was really funny. Then we fell on the floor and laughed, and we all held on to Fred's feet the rest of the night.
Did you say the sinner's prayer again?
I think between seeing those two little prayer partners disappear and Fred gone, I said a quick sinner's prayer. And then the little prayer partners came out and went, "What's wrong?" And I went, "Oh, nothing."
You had to be there.
I'll tell you, that happened to, I think it was my sister, yes, and me many years ago, when we were all going to sit down to a big Thanksgiving dinner, and I was just probably 12 or 13 years old, and my sister's a few years older than I am. And they had decided to go out to the cemetery, which was near our home, just, you know, it would only take 10 or 15 minutes to go and come right back where my father is buried. And so we walked in, and here's the turkey on the table, the soup, you know, everything is hot, the stove is on, and there's not a soul in the house. And I mean, I got on my knees that time and prayed through, and thank God they all showed up a few minutes later, but I understand the feeling, is what I guess what I'm saying.
Are we writing a script for...
Yeah, maybe something.
Hey, could this be developed maybe into some kind of a motion picture made for TV? That would really, I mean, you know, a lot of people poke fun at this, but I want to tell you all something. This Bible talks about a time when all living believers upon planet Earth are going to be caught up off of this planet to meet the Lord Jesus Christ in the air. Now, laugh and scoff if you will, but I want to tell you something. This Bible is basically one-third prophecy. Of that one-third, two-thirds of it has already come to pass precisely as the prophets of old predicted. There's a simple little test in the book of Deuteronomy for what constitutes a true prophet. In the good old days, the Jewish people, if a man claimed to be a prophet and prophesied and his prophecy did not come to pass, he was stoned. So erstwhile prophets didn't last very long in the land of Israel. They were taken out of the way. A true prophet was known by the fact that his prophecies came to pass, not 99 and 44 100%, but 100%, just as the Spirit of God spoke them through him. Isn't it reasonable to believe that if this Bible is one-third prophecy, and of that one-third, two-thirds of it has already come to pass precisely as the prophets declared and predicted, isn't it reasonable to assume that the remaining one-third will also come to pass, amen, just as this precious old book says it will? And I know, in fact, those of you that are laughing and scoffing, did you know you yourself are a sign that this Bible talks about? Because the Bible says that in the last days, just prior to the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ, there will come scoffers and mockers and those who will ridicule and make fun and say, where is the sign of his coming? All things are as they have been from the beginning. Seed time, harvest, summer and winter. Where is the sign of his coming? And I want to tell you something, dear friends. There'll come a time, and I shudder sometimes to think about this, but did you know that there will be a day in this very studio in which we are sitting? There will be people on this floor, on this set. They will be weeping, they will be screaming, they will be wailing, they will be gnashing their teeth. They will be saying, those crazy Christians that we ridiculed were absolutely right. This Bible is true. Now it is too late for us. Tim, I don't know. I think we may have the beginnings of a script here, because these are things that I believe we are going to live to see. All things being equal, some will probably go on to be with Christ, but I think these next few years, these next 7 or 8 years, are absolutely going to be the most crucial, awesome, mind-blowing, mind-boggling years in the history of planet Earth. How do you beat an angel choir singing as a baby is born in Bethlehem, and shepherd boys running to see a newborn king, and wise men coming, and all of the great events that we read about in this holy book? But I want to tell you, there are far more awesome and fearful events that are predicted in this Bible than has ever been seen or witnessed upon planet Earth. But I am firmly convinced, and other godly men and women that I know and have talked to are firmly convinced, that we are that terminal generation that will be alive on planet Earth when these awesome and fearful portents spoken of in the book of Revelation, in the book of Daniel, literally come to pass on this earth in our lifetimes. Laugh and scoff if you will. As I said before, you yourself are one of the signs Christ said in his book we should look for as one of the important signs of the nearness of his second coming. I think we ought to just pray. I believe there are some of you out there that you have heard this word, and the Holy Spirit in his convicting power has gripped your soul and your very heart. And I want to pray a simple little prayer for you right now. Some of you that are under the sound of my voice tonight, there is nothing I can say, there is nothing God can do, there is nothing the Holy Spirit can do. You have hardened your heart, and you are lost. You are as good as dead right now. Some of you, under the sound of my voice, in a matter of a few short days, weeks, months, or years, will find yourselves in a burning pit of hell, screaming and crying and remembering this night that you heard a crazy TV evangelist that you were ridiculing and making fun of warned you and told you of a God in heaven who at this moment in time is a merciful, all-loving Savior, but who soon will become an awesome and fearful judge. For the scriptures say it is an awesome and fearful thing to fall into the hands of an angry God. I want to pray a simple prayer right now, and I want everyone in my audience tonight that knows Christ in a personal way to agree with me right now that the faithful Holy Spirit will now do that precious work of grace that only He can do. We can talk about this great word, we can warn you, we can teach, preach, and sing, and tell. But I will ever know that it is only the faithful Holy Spirit who can woo you and win you and draw you and pull you by His mighty power to the bleeding side of Jesus Christ. The good news is you don't have to die. You don't have to be lost. You don't have to suffer. You don't have to go through this. Jesus says, pray that you may be accounted worthy to escape all these things that are coming upon the earth and to stand before the Son of Man. The best news I could say to the whole world tonight, and oh God, if I ever had the chance one time, I would say these words. The best news is it's not too late to know Jesus Christ and to escape the horrible things that are coming upon this earth. Just a few days ago, I was awestruck as it seemed like every day another awesome event happened. The awful hurricane that swept through Florida. Days later, a rare earthquake hits Utah, of all places. Then here comes that awful earthquake off of Nicaragua and wipes out a whole coastline, and thousands are missing. Then another horrible killer hurricane sweeps through Hawaii. Then Guam is nearly swept off of the ocean. And then great floods in Pakistan and Italy, yes, and China, tidal waves washing whole cities off of the coastlines of China. Then all of a sudden, great eruptions of volcanoes in Guatemala all the way up to Alaska. Partners, this world is beginning to convulse. And I believe with all my heart that it is what Jesus described in Matthew 24, Luke chapter 21, Mark chapter 13 as the beginnings of sorrows. We are literally living through part of this prophetic word right now. We are living in prophetic days, I believe with all my heart. What awaits us up ahead, I can tell you, this Bible is very precise. There's coming a time when those who know Christ are going to be taken up and we'll be gone. We are presently the salt and the light. What would this world be like if we didn't have Christian believers who were holding back the forces of evil? What would this world become in a matter of hours if the salt and the light and the body of Christ and the spirit of Christ that lives within us that holds back the flood tide of evil were suddenly removed from this earth? I want to tell you, friend, that's going to happen very soon. And you think you've seen evil now, and you think you hear evil now. Just today, as Jan and I were driving in the car, just in a matter of a few minutes, a terrible robbery, shootout with the police, murder, mayhem, massacres.
Someone taken out of their own car.
Absolutely the most horrible things. You listen to the news is the most depressing thing you can listen to these days. I don't like to even hear it anymore. It's so horrible what's happening on the face of the earth. But after this body of Christ is evacuated from planet Earth, I want to tell you, this is not going to be a pretty place to be. All hell is going to break loose on planet Earth, and a very smart and so-called wise man is going to arise and seize the reins of power worldwide, and he will be known to us, at least, as the Antichrist. And you read it in the book of Revelation, and for 42 months he's going to hold power over the earth, and then the last 42 months is when God's wrath is poured out and the great angels of God fly back and forth across the whole wide world and pour out seven great bowls or vials of wrath upon the earth. It says that the sun will go seven times hotter, men will and women will gnaw their tongues for the intense heat and pain. They will cry for the rocks and the mountains to fall upon them to hide them from the face of an angry God. But the most perplexing thing to me in all of that is I read this amazing account. Is in the midst of all of this trouble and turmoil and hell on earth, it says that men and women repented not, but blasphemed God and would not turn from their wicked ways. I can't understand that, but it's in the book, and it's going to happen on planet Earth in your lifetime and mine. You want to stay around for it? You can. Some of you are going to bust hell wide open, and there's not a word I can say to you that'll keep you from it, because God won't violate your free will. You make the choice. I want us to pray right now, and I want us to believe God for a mighty move of the Holy Spirit upon the hearts of men and women. Will you join me in this prayer right now? Heavenly Father, we ask you now for your precious Holy Spirit to move upon the hearts of men and women, boys and girls. Oh God, awaken men and women to the awful things that are coming upon this earth, and cause them to cry out to you now for forgiveness, for peace of heart and peace of mind and the assurance that their souls are right with you. Holy Spirit, do that precious work that only you can do. Bring mighty conviction upon the hearts and souls of men and women, boys and girls, and bring them now, we pray, to the foot of the cross, where the blood of Christ can cleanse and forgive and make them children of Almighty God. I want you to pray a little prayer with me. Church, will you pray it with me? Because so often people will come to me and say, Paul, thank you for leading me in a little prayer. I'd never prayed a prayer. I'd never been to church. I didn't know how to pray. But you helped me in my first little prayer, and God heard me and saved me. Oh, honey, do you remember just up in, we bumped into a beautiful little couple, a young man. He'd been a Los Angeles police officer.
She was in the New Age.
His wife had gotten involved in the New Age movement and all this weird stuff that's going on, and this Satan's counterfeit. The New Age is Satan's counterfeit to the real age that's coming, dear friends. And they had heard a word on TBN, and she had given her heart to Christ, and then she led him to Christ. And now this beautiful couple and their little child were standing there just beaming and hugging Jan and me and saying, thank you, thank you, thank you for bringing us the message. And now he's going into the ministry and going to literally be first of all an assistant pastor and then a pastor of a church. But somebody took the time on a program just like tonight to lead them in a little prayer, something like this. Will you all pray it with me right now? Just say this little prayer out loud. Oh God,
oh God,
I'm a sinner.
I'm a sinner.
I need a Savior.
I need a Savior.
I do believe,
I do believe
Jesus Christ,
Jesus Christ
is that Savior.
Is that Savior.
I do believe,
I do believe
His precious blood,
His precious blood
cleanses me now,
cleanses me now
from every sin.
From every sin.
Come into my heart.
Come into my heart.
Lord Jesus.
Lord Jesus.
Be my Savior.
Be my Savior.
Now and forever.
Now and forever.
Amen.
Amen.
If you prayed that simple little prayer and meant it with all your heart, God's greatest miracle is yours, and you don't have to fear these awesome events that this book talks about that are soon to come upon us. You can join us in doing what Jesus said to do. When you see these things begin to come to pass, lift up your heads and rejoice, for your redemption draweth nigh, is even at the doors. So if you've prayed that simple little prayer, hurry to a phone right now. Call me. Please do it right now. And do what the Word of God says to do. Confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus. Believing in your heart that God raised Him from the dead, it says, you shall be saved. For whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. I want to hear from you right now. And Tim and Tim, I don't know. Have we got a little
seed thought? I think the Lord was speaking through you.
For something that we could commit to a powerful media known as film that would even impress, you know, with proper graphics and visualization and some of the things. Hey, somehow I believe God's going to help us commit some of these things that will at least get the world's attention and make them stop and think.
Amen.
And if we can at least get them to focus and give a fair hearing to the Word of God,
that's the issue.
They will most naturally then, I think, come to know Christ as Savior.
Amen.
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 Any little comments coming in yet, sweetheart?
Yes, very, very good ones. Said, please, someone make movies out of some of the wonderful Christian novels. You know, they're already written.
Yeah.
You know what? Somebody told me that this present darkness is being committed.
Made.
Do you know if it is,
yes,
Tim?
Yes, I know something about that. The three people that are attempting to get that made, I think they finished a screenplay on it. And
really?
They're attempting to get it placed at a studio. So I don't know the update on it, but it's...
That's our kind of film. I don't know if they'll need any of our help or not, but I pray that that kind of drama could be committed to to film. Yes.
Someone said that when you do a movie about Armageddon, please remember that the younger children love it too. You know, they love to know about end times, and to keep them in mind when we're writing it. That's interesting. Someone's talking about the Azusa Street Revival would make, you know, at least that'd make a good documentary.
A historical documentary. I think somebody's done that.
Yeah, we showed a little bit of it Monday night. Leon Isaac Kennedy has done a documentary on it. It's wonderful. How about a movie about grandparents telling the children of the miracles of the church? You know.
How about Oral Roberts?
Yeah, really.
Talking about that and maybe putting in some of the scenes of those great miracles from the tents.
You know, there was a period in the 50s and the 60s when healing revivals and healings were just, it was like God's time for healing, and it was just beautiful. See, here's another one. Make anything on Armageddon, the rapture, the tribulation. Would love to see any of that, anything about the end times from San Juan Capistrano. Just a lot of beautiful ideas.
Do you see a pattern there?
Well, most of them are talking about end times. Here's someone, how about a movie of Joshua? Said he's such a powerful character and no one's ever really made...
That's true.
Yeah.
That would fit into your Heroes of the Faith series.
Uh-huh. He is... the Old Testament Jesus, actually.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Right.
Just they're all about the same thing. Any more ideas, you let us know.
Send them on in. We've still got a little time here.
There's probably some. Here's some right here. Thank you, Daniel.
I tell you what, I'd like you to all see the other video that we did with Roger McDuff and Jack Holcomb called... what is the other one? How Great Thou Art. How Great Thou Art. Let's get that up and have a quick look at it. And then, Vern, maybe you can get ready for a final song. Oh, yeah.
For all we'll get to see Babushka.
Maybe.
Is Babushka
coming? Are you saving 20 minutes for her?
We have 20. Yes, we have almost 30 minutes left.
Okay.
would you maybe give us just a little of the quick background on Babushka? As to where she came from, and
but just before she comes, do you want to do it?
Yes.
Or you want me to do it right now?
Well, finish up all of the movie ideas.
Movie on the rapture, beautiful. Someone said, "How about Roy and Dale Evans' life?"
It's a great.
I think Tim has already written to that.
You have a script on that, don't you?
Yes.
It would be a great.
Oh, The Beautiful Side of Evil. That's a book written by Johanna Michelson. It's incredible. Would like to see a film on the end times. A documentary, on the end times. Would like to see a film on the Book of Acts.
Yeah.
I'll give all these to you. Mm-hmm. Movie on the end times.
There's a pattern.
Film on the Battle of Armageddon. Mm-hmm. My goodness. Said, don't forget the teenagers, that they'll be very interested in end times if you...
Mm-hmm. Oh, they really are. That's one thing, you know, your Barry was mentioning earlier. One thing us old fogies have got to get past is that there's a young audience out there that really needs to be touched. And sometimes I know I feel like an old man when it comes to what I like, you know. And I think that what we have to be careful about is exactly that something that would reach into young people as well as us older folks, and I think that's possible to do
because it's the young people who are going to films.
The Hollywood has so passed us older folks by till we don't go anymore. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's a very rarity for Jan and I to.
Yeah.
I just don't care for the bill of fare that Hollywood's cranking out right now.
That's right.
And give me an old World War II movie and I'll pop it in my VCR at home and, you know, let me see old Blood and Guts Patton, you know.
Or John Wayne or something.
Go after that paper.
We have 7 minutes till Bush gets
here. 7 minutes, okay. Well, I was waxing eloquent on General Patton. Go ahead.
Well, the story of this little puppet, Bushka, and then we'll go to the song, Hello Mama, and then Bushka.
Shall we save the song maybe for the very end,
okay,
and we can say goodnight?
Yeah. Right.
Good.
Well, let's just go right to her then, right after I give the little history. Matthew, when our Matthew was born 30 years ago, he was at age 4. We found out that Matthew was blind in his right eye. And it was a real, real shock to us as a family. And We did a lot of praying and a lot of soul searching, just a lot of pain that a lot of you go through when you get a serious word in your family. Well, as a result, Matthew became our little eternal baby. We carried him around, and he was just our little
clown.
Little clown, little pal, and he and I just became more like pals. And he had several little characters that he did, and I had this character that was a little naughty girl that just talked to him all the time, and we named her Babushka. I don't even know why. I found out later that it means grandma in Russian. It's grandma, Russian grandma, and I didn't even know it. Anyway, one Christmas, I had a box under the tree from Matthew about 12 years ago, and I opened it, and there was this little pink puppet. And I said, what in the world? He said, Mama, I said, that was Babushka. I said, when I saw this in the store, said, this is the little girl that I saw talking to me all the years that you and I had this little thing going back and forth. So Babushka became a little living character then.
Yes.
And I came on behind the scenes one time about 12 years ago and did a little story with Paul playing the straight man. And she just got out of hand completely.
She was my special guest on Behind the Scenes
once
that day. And
and letters poured in.
Letters came in.
But we had her on anyway.
So I think this is the story of
Joseph
and his coat of many colors as told only
by
Babushka. This is... Mercy! Where have you been, Babushka? I've missed you. How you doing?
Wow!
What?
What's all the big deal about being pink and not having a nose and maybe no legs and stuff? I've lived with that all my life.
I know. You do rather well, too.
No big deal, Pa.
Jan carries you around and everything, doesn't
we'll
she?
We'll see. Because I'm on the inside looking out.
Yes.
And because Jesus is in my heart. And...
Well, I like little pink people very much. And Jesus likes little pink people very
Thank
much.
Thank you, Pa.
Yes.
Oh,
I like
you look funny upside down.
I like your eyelashes, too.
Pa.
And your little bow ribbons.
I like you, too. You're so...
Have you got a story for me today? And for the boys and girls over there?
What would you like for me to tell?
Have you been reading the Bible? Have you been studying the Word?
Well, sometimes I read the Bible. Sometimes I don't. Sometimes I read other things.
Well, yes, that's all right. The Lord doesn't expect us to read nothing but the Bible. Just always... Read the Bible, too.
Yes. All right.
Well, I have heard, I don't know where I picked this up, maybe Jan told me or somebody, but something about you were going to get into the story of Joseph and his coat of many colors today.
Pa! Joseph! You mean that one, Pa?
Yes.
The one that...
What one was that?
Well, the one that almost got in trouble, and I don't know what they're always talking about in the Bible, but if you do it, it's like bananas and stuff, you know
well,
what I mean?
Well, when you get a little older, you know, Jan will be able to counsel with you and talk with you about some of these grown-up things that really you don't need to know.
But you always say that.
Everything about...
You always say that, and I never hear anything. Oh, okay.
Well, why don't we start at the beginning? You have about 15 or 20 minutes.
You mean in the beginning God created that one in the beginning? Okay.
No. The beginning of Joseph.
Okay.
Joseph was one of the 12 sons of
Jacob.
Yes. Abraham, Isaac, Jacob. Yes. And then Jacob had 12 sons. Do you know their names?
Excuse me, Pa? Do you?
I think I know most of them. I wouldn't want to be quizzed on it on one-way game,
no,
I'll tell you that right
I'm
now.
I'm sorry, that's niche,
yes.
Noop.
Well, I know that Joseph was, I think, next to the youngest. Wasn't Benjamin the youngest?
Well,
yes, I believe so.
Don't ask me questions, and I'll tell you no fibs.
Okay. Tell me about
it. So there was a little boy.
Yes.
17 years old.
Yes.
And one day he was walking around the house going to dream the impossible.
song wasn't even written yet.
Well, but he had a dream.
Yes.
And he went to his daddy and he told him, "Daddy, I had a dream that my brothers bowed down to me." And his daddy said, "Don't tell your brothers, because they'll knock your old cute head off." So anyway, so he was dreaming all the time, and one day he was out in the field, and he said, "Brothers, did you know I had a dream about you? That one day you were going to bow down to me."
Mm. That doesn't create good relationships.
Me, little kid, bow down to a niche. Yuck! So, then Joseph ran in the house. He said, "Daddy, Mom, come here, man, I'll tell you something. My brothers were doing bad things out in the field. Bad things, you know what I mean? Bad. Like smoking corn silks and stuff." And, So, his dad was getting all the gossip from Joseph, and it made the brothers mad.
Mm.
But one day, the mother loved little Joseph, too. And she was sewing and sewing and sewing and sewing and sewing. She said, "Jojo, come in here just a minute. I have something to show you." So, he went in the room, and she had made the
No, it was a beautiful.
It had pink and turquoise and lights on it, and it lit up, and it had "go for it" and all that stuff just written all over it. And so Joseph put it on and went, "I feel like Michael Jackson. I think I'll sing Beat It, Beat It, Da 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 Da."
No, excuse me. Okay. We don't sing that, only on real videos.
Then, he put on this coat, and he went out in the field.
Oh.
He was moonwalking, Pa. So then, his brothers went, "Oh, no! Not the little ratter that told on us that we were smoking weeds and stuff." Then, on top of that, he had this dream that he was gonna have all of us bow down. Then look at that coat! Excuse me. So, they said, "We've had it." And so they went over, and one of them started plotting.
Mm.
"You know, he's getting all the new clothes. Next, he's gonna be getting Levi's and Jordache and this kind of stuff. And I've had it, you know what I mean?"
Mm-hmm.
So they started planning his death. Ooh. And one of them said, "Let's take that tacky coat, put some blood on it, and kill him and take it to his daddy." And Reuben came up and said, "No, I will not be a part of shedding blood. Let's throw him in a well." The others said, well, that's not a bad idea.
I guess if I had my choice of being killed or thrown in a well, I'd take the well, too.
So they put him in a well. And then they looked, and down the road was coming some some llamas with humps on them. No.
Camels.
No, it was horses with bad breath and long necks. No, it was, what did you say, Pa?
I think they were camels. It was a caravan.
Would you walk a mile for one of those ugly suckers?
No, I would not.
Who would walk a mile for a bad breath camel? Excuse me?
Let's move on.
So anyway, so they came by, and the Reuben said, "Let's sell Joseph to these guys, and he could be their slave. We could take the coat back to Daddy, tell him that he was killed by a wild animal."
Oh,
so,
yes.
When the camels came by, they went, "Whew! Excuse me? While I hold my nose from the camel breath, would you like to buy this little kid? And they sold Joseph to the Midianites.
Their own brother.
Their own brother.
Oh, my.
Pa. So, anyway. They went down, and he lived in Egypt. But Pa, he didn't let all that bad bother him. Joseph worked and worked and worked and worked and worked and worked. And he was in Potiphar's house.
Yes.
And he worked and he got, he got to be the head of the household.
Mm-hmm.
And Potiphar was one of Pharaoh's favorite administrators.
Because Joseph trusted in the living God and gave his life to God and loved God. And God was with Joseph.
Yes.
Yes.
That's right. And he didn't let being in a whale get him down. He
right.
didn't even let his brothers
Very
bother him.
Good.
He just knew that he trusted in God. So then, he worked around Mr. Potiphar's house, and one day, the phone rang.
The phone?
And he picked up the phone. Hello, this is Joseph. And on the other end of the line says, put your sweet lips a little closer to the phone. Who is this? Who is this? Let's pretend that we're together. Who is this? That sounds like Mrs. Potiphar. So,
it was.
All of a sudden, she peeps around the door and says, hello, little cute thing. Ah! Oh, no. What is going on? Joseph? Excuse me, Joseph. Would you like to come into my parlor?
Well, I don't know if
Potiphar
was bad, but she did try to tempt Joseph in a very wrong way.
And it scared him, Paul.
Yes.
And he grabbed his coat, and he started to run out. And Mrs. Potiphar grabbed his coat, pulled it off of him, and got it as Joseph just ran out the door. So, when Joseph got home that night, he opened the door and peeped in, and Potiphar was standing there.
Mr. Potiphar.
He said, Joseph, what did you do to my wife? And Joseph said, you mean your fat wife, sir? And he said, well, she's the best I could get, because I look like Zola Levitt. You know what I mean? Anyway, Pa, I mean...
Zola Levitt?
Paul, have we kind of gotten off the track?
A little bit.
Anyway,
let's get back to the story now,
so,
why don't we?
He said, I didn't do anything, sir. Zola, sir. And he said...
Potiphar.
You are going to prison. Whew.
Mm.
Pa? Joseph had never done anything. He'd been in a whale. He'd been in jail. But somehow, he knew God was going to see him through.
Yes.
So he went to jail. And he worked so hard, and he did everything, and he whistled, and he did it all, and he watched TV and on TV and saw a praise program and all the things right in prison. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So he knew God was with him. And so, one day, he got word that Pharaoh had had a dream.
Who's
now,
Pharaoh?
We'll skip over a whole bunch. Pharaoh was the king of the land.
Of Egypt.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
And so, two of the men that had been in prison with him remembered that he had, what do you call it when you do a dream? Interpreted a dream of theirs.
Yes.
And it's come true.
Yes.
So Pharaoh was going around, who can interpret this dream? I dream about fat cows, I dream about skinny cows, and I don't know what to do about it. And all of a sudden, the chief baker, he said, would you? Says, you know, I knew a man that interpreted my dream. So Pharaoh said, call him. So Joseph came and Pharaoh said, I dreamed that there were 7 fat cows and 7 little skinny cows. And but what happened?
Well, he just had that dream. He dreamed in the one dream that there were 7 very big, fat, beautiful cows. And then he had another dream and there were 7 very skinny little cows. And he didn't understand what it meant.
And so Joseph said, sir, it means that we're going to have 7 years of plenty and 7 years of famine.
Yes.
And so he thought, my goodness, if 3 of your dream interpretations have come true, I should put you in charge of everything we do.
Yes, and he made Joseph the 2nd most important ruler in the whole land of Egypt.
Paul, it's because Joseph didn't pout and cry and scream and yell and
good.
Beat on the rails in the prison. He just sat and watched praise program and didn't fuss or nothing.
And so, trusted the Lord.
Yes, that's the best part.
Yes.
So then, they had 7 years of wonderful prosperity. Everybody grew all the grain and everything, and they stored it in the barns.
Yes.
Stored it, because the famine was coming. So then, one day, the 7 years were up, and the famine started.
Mm.
Oh, my. Paul, it was kind of like over in Ethiopia, you know what I mean?
Yes, yes.
The little people were starving. So one day, a knock came at the door, and it was somebody very familiar to Joseph. And he looked out, and there were his brothers. They were coming to bow down to ask the leader of all the food storage for some food.
Mm.
Joseph ran and he cried because he knew the dream that God had given him had just come true. And he gave his brothers grain, and he gave them all they needed. But he said, do you have a father? And could you bring him to see me?
Because the brothers didn't recognize Joseph yet at all, did they?
No, they didn't.
No.
And he said, yes, we have a father. He's very, very old, but we'll bring him. And Joseph cried, and he was so happy. He knew that his father loved him and had always loved him. And one day he was waiting, and he looked way down the road. And he said, there comes my daddy.
Mm.
And he had a family reunion, Paul, and he'd stayed true to God. And God restored him his family. And he got to be leader, and his family got, and they got to eat. And you know what, Paul?
Hmm.
His precious father sat down one day with all the brothers when they were all restored. And he prophesied to each one of them.
Yes.
He told Reuben what he would be, and he told all the other brothers, and Benjamin, and I wish I could remember their name, Paul.
Manasseh,
yes.
Zebulun. And
and he sat down and he told them their future. And he said, goodbye, boys. I'm going home. And he laid down and closed his eyes and went to heaven.
Hmm.
And you know what Joseph said, Paul?
Hmm.
He said, will you brothers do me one favor? When I die, don't leave my bones in Egypt. Take them back to Canaan land. And they promised that because of what Joseph had done, that he didn't kill them and he didn't hate them, that when he died, they would take his bones back to their homeland. And they did. And everybody lived happily ever after.
Oh, a beautiful story. I love it.
Thank you, Pa.
Yes, yes, yes. Babushka rides again. Could it be that as the Lord has called Oral Robert into a new phase of ministry, that he is also calling Babushka into a new phase of ministry?
A new day.
Could this be?
Well.
Babushka, get your mic on. I mean, Jan, get your mic on.
Well, she's going to be a part of Matt and Lori's
yes.
program. So.
Radical, romping,
yes.
devil stomping, ever loving, whatever. Curtain climbing's kids club or whatever. So she will be a regular,
She'll
I
be
understand.
A regular on their program, yes.
I think Babushka has to do some taping sometime this
yeah,
week,
I think
as a
it's
matter
Wednesday.
Fact.
Mm-hmm.
That would be tomorrow.
Mm-hmm.
I see. Does she have some new stories kind of
well,
on the drawing board?
She's been reading a few very interesting stories in the Old Testament.
Well,
she loves the Old Testament.
I'm glad we're through Joseph, at least. now we can move on to other...
So is Joseph.
...other safer stories.
He's listening yes. from heaven. It didn't happen like that at all.
Yes, yes. Well, how much time we got? About a minute? Okay. Thank God. Richard from Vestonburg, Michigan, just received Christ. Sherry from Rancho Palos Verdes, 42, received Christ. David from Rio Rancho, New Mexico, 27, receiving Christ. Nella from New Boston, Michigan, receiving Christ. Mira from Corona, California. Ray from Cincinnati, Ohio. And we rejoice that many are coming to saving knowledge of Jesus
and
Christ.
And this Thursday night, Benny Hinn is going to be here in the
oh, yes.
studio.
Yes.
2442 Michelle Drive in Tustin, California. Benny will be here at 7 o'clock. We'll be hosting the program.
Thank you, Vern Jackson,
yes,
for
sir,
taking
Paul.
Us higher one more time. Thank you, Tim Penland, for the good report on China Cry. And
Thank
Tim...
Mashler.
Mashler. From Burbank also. Did you get any ideas for some scripts for...
We got to start here.
A lot of more people.
And thank you, partners, for all of your ideas. We'll give these to Tim and Tim as they leave. And the Lord willing and the creek don't rise, we will see some new movies here in the near future made for TV, made for your Trinity Broadcasting Network that will be soul-winning great dramas. God bless you all. It's been a good night. Continue to call. Even after this program goes off the air, prayer partners will stay with you to talk with you, love you, and lead you to the Lord Jesus Christ. Good night. God love you. We love you. And remember, let everything that hath breath keep on
praising
the Lord.
Amen.
Good night, everybody.
Amen.
We love
Amen.
You.
Amen. Amen.
There's so many.
So glad you've been with us for Praise the Lord. If you'd like an audio cassette of Praise the Lord, please write and ask for program 1006-92. That's 1006-92. The tapes will be sent for your love gift to the Praise the Lord program. TBN has a worldwide ministry. We need your love gifts, large or small, to help keep the gospel of Jesus Christ going around the world. So write today, Praise the Lord, P.O. Box A, Santa Ana, California, 92711. Or in Canada, write TBN, P.O. Box 24215, APO, Richmond, British Columbia, V7B1Y2. If you haven't asked Christ into your life, call our prayer partner now and pray to receive Jesus as Savior and Lord. Now, until next time, remember to praise the Lord.
This program was brought to you by the prayers and contributions of our faithful partners throughout North America and the world.